Norman, Oklahoma. Ranked University of Nebraska Cornhuskers take on the Sooners of Oklahoma. This 7TV sports presentation is brought to you by Northwestern Bell, Xena, True Value Hardware, those friendly people at the Ralston Bank, home of innovative banking, Nebraska Furniture Mart. When you shop the Nebraska Furniture Mart, you'll know that you got the best for less. And by Runza, home of the sandwich that's a meal in itself. Now, KETV Sports Director Wayne DeZubak and Nebraska Athletic Director Bob Devaney.
A capacity crowd of nearly 75,000 people continue to file in here at Oklahoma Memorial Stadium, Owen Field, on the campus of the University of Oklahoma, for today's Big 8 showdown between the Nebraska Cornhuskers with an 8-2 record overall, 6-0 in the Big 8 Conference, and the Oklahoma Sooners, who are having indeed a below-par season at 5-3-1 overall, 3-1-1 in the Big 8 Conference. It will be a beautiful day for college football here in Norman. The temperature expected to climb to about 60 degrees. The winds out of the southeast at about 5 to 10 miles per hour. So on a November 21st day, you could not ask for a more perfect day. Hello, everybody. I'm Wayne DeZubak, and I am happy today to be working with the man who 10 years ago on this very same field engineered that game of the decade, Nebraska's 35-31 win over the Oklahoma Sooners, the athletic director at the University of Nebraska, Bob Devaney. And Bob, did it seem like 10 years ago now?
Wayne, the time goes by awful fast. But, you know, I think it's going to be a lot easier to coach this game up here 10 years later than it was that day down there, because that was a tough afternoon.
I'll tell you what, I hope we have a game just as exciting as that. But I'll tell you, there are a couple of problems. First of all, Nebraska, Turner Gill is sitting home with a leg injury. He is not here. How much will that affect the Huskers?
Well, it certainly will affect us. Turner Gill's a fine all-around quarterback, maybe coming on to being the greatest quarterback we've ever had. But I think Mark Maurer, a senior who was elected captain by his teammates, I feel that the players will rally around him. Mark will be playing today without the thought, well, if I make a mistake, there's somebody right there behind me. I think he's going to feel that he has to carry the load, and I look for Mark to do a good job.
Tight end Jamie Williams is here. He may or may not play, though.
Well, Jamie has had knee problems, and it's a question. He may start, or Tom may put him in there along towards as the game moves along to see how he gets along. But I'm not sure just whether how effective Jamie will be.
Okay, and of course, for the Oklahoma Sooners, a guy named Chet Winters is not going to be here, so that'll be the most noticeable aspect of it. We will continue our pregame show from Norman, Oklahoma, so stay with us here on 7TV. Well, Nebraska may have won the game of the decade, but obviously the Oklahoma Sooners have dominated the decade itself. Tom Osborne against Barry Switzer coach teams is only 1-8. Tom's only victory coming in 1978. That, of course, that big 17-14 win in Lincoln. The last couple of games, they have been close, but the Sooners have won them. Here's now a look at the last three games, Oklahoma and Nebraska.
1978 was a bittersweet year for Nebraska. On a cold November day, the Huskers beat Oklahoma 17-14. It was their first win over the Sooners since back in 1971. However, Nebraska did not wrap up the win until Billy Sims fumbled on the Husker 3-yard line and Jim Pillen recovered. But 1 week later, the Huskers lost to Missouri, thus falling into a tie with Oklahoma for the Big 8 championship. Both teams went to the Orange Bowl, where the Sooners got revenge 31-24 New Year's night, a bittersweet year for Nebraska in 1978. In 79, Nebraska came to Norman, Oklahoma. They did so with a perfect 10-0 record, but a man named Billy Sims was just too much for an entire blackshirt squad. He ran it well, seemingly unstoppable. Only Sooner mistakes, for instance an untimely clip, ruined an otherwise near-perfect day for Billy Sims. And what about J.C. Watts? Well, Watts was not one to throw a pass, but on that day, the ball he did indeed put in the air. Nebraska was surprised when Forrest Valora was wide open, resulting in a Sooner touchdown. But the Huskers answered that challenge with some passing of their own. And late in the game, after a little swing pass to Jarvis Redwine, Oklahoma's lead read only 10-7. Then it was Billy Sims again. He broke things wide open with a long run deep into Nebraska territory, taunting Nebraska players on his route. Finally, J.C. Watts closed the door with a 3-yard scamper, and the Sooners at this point had a commanding 17-7 margin. Then came the trick play of the day. Husker guard Randy Schleusner became a household word. Nebraska quarterback Jeff Quinn deliberately dropped the ball under the center. Guard Randy Schleusner scooped it up, and he ran home with power for the score, and that made the final 17-14 Oklahoma. Nebraska never really recovered from that game. They went on to lose in the Cotton Bowl to Houston, the final 17-14. But 1980, last year, was the most bittersweet of all for Husker fans. Nebraska came out in that game rolling. In fact, the Huskers had built a 10-0 lead over the Sooners before Oklahoma really knew what had happened. The big run, of course, provided by I-back Jarvis Redwine. But it was J.C. Watts, number one, who brought his troops back, and Oklahoma jumped into a 14-10 lead. Then, with 3 minutes remaining, Nebraska took advantage of a terrible Oklahoma punt and punched home yet another touchdown. The score now read 17-14 Nebraska with less than 3 minutes to play in the game. Then Nebraska was called for an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty 15 yards against the Huskers, followed by Buster Rhymes, number four, ran through the Huskers, and it was clear that Oklahoma was making another miracle appear. Rhymes then brought home victory with a minute to go. No time for Nebraska to recover. Oklahoma had won the 1980 game 21-14. Well, as we all know, the Nebraska Cornhuskers have already wrapped up that Big A championship. They did it last week, of course, when they beat Iowa State and Oklahoma lost to the Sooners. And it marks the first time in the 54-year history of the conference, be it the Big 6, the Big 7, or the Big 8, that a team has wrapped up the conference championship with all the teams having at least one game remaining in their regular season. Now, earlier this week, we had a chance to talk with some of the Nebraska players, and they say that their 81 season won't be complete until they beat the Oklahoma Sooners.
I'd be lying to you if I said I wasn't feeling some pressure. There's a little bit there. There's definitely going to be some pressure. But hopefully it's the kind of pressure that, you know, won't affect me. It's the kind that I'm looking forward to. It's going to be a challenge for me, really. It's an opportunity where I'm going to be able to get a chance to play and see if I can't play a little bit better and improve. You know, the situation that's come about through my year, you know, it's something that's happened. Turner stepped in and did such a good job where, you know, looking at it realistically, I had to accept that. So, you know, it's an opportunity where I'm called on to see if I can't do the job that it'll take to win the ball game.
Jimmy, even though this is not for the Big A championship, is this still a big game against Oklahoma?
Yeah, it is. It's a big game because every year is a big game. It's a great rival between Nebraska and Oklahoma. I think it's a big game also because we like to win the Big A clear cut. We like to beat all the Big A teams. And I'm sure there'll be some feelings for some seniors in their last game. So it's big in a lot of ways.
Oh, it's probably the biggest game of my career. I've played against them twice and lost both times, so I really am hungry to beat them.
How good is their wishbone attack?
I think it's as good as ever. I think they still have the back, Shepard and Stanley Wilson, of course, is a very fine fullback. And the strength of their offense is in their offensive line. They've got three or four starters back from last year, and they were really good then. So I think their offense is really good.
Well, this game is going to be a big one for me and for the whole team entirely. We're trying to go down there and beat those guys so we have a perfect, you know, conference record.
Oklahoma's always a big one. In the years past, we've always seemed to be able to beat them. You know, we've always been coming in with a lot of momentum and stuff, and they've always seemed to beat us for some reason. I think this year, I think we can do it.
How good is Oklahoma's defense? Can they stop the Nebraska running game?
Well, let's say I hope not. But they're going to have some guys out there that, you know, are young but with a good athletic ability. So I don't think they can stop us because we're going to be running hard.
They definitely look good on film. Other teams have had some good luck throwing the ball against them. They seem to be susceptible against the pass. On the other hand, there's been some times where they've been able to, you know, teams have run against them. So it's just a matter of us, you know, our team going out and executing and doing what we can do best. We're going to try to go at them, put the ball on the ground, and see if we can't do the things that we can do.
I think it's a very big game. I think all the players are really looking forward to it. I know that, you know, we don't want to spend the next 5-6 weeks before the Orange Bowl game coming off a loss. We really want to go down there and play a good football game.
How bad does the team want this one?
Very bad. You know, Oklahoma has gotten the best of us in previous games, and we like to really beat them.
They are having fun here in Norman, Oklahoma this afternoon, and we'll be back in a minute to take a look at the road to the Big 8 for Nebraska. So stay with us as we have more pregame show from Norman.
Well, there's no place like Nebraska in Norman, Oklahoma today. The temperature about 55 degrees, a beautiful afternoon for college football. You know, we've talked about Nebraska winning the Big 8 title. It all started on October 10th against Colorado. Since then, Nebraska reeled off five straight victories to go 6-0 in the conference. Here's a look at how they did it. Nebraska's road to the Big 8 football championship began at the expense of the University of Colorado. They beat the Buffaloes 59-0. First play, second period now. Rozier for the touchdown, finds a hole, scampers in. 21-0, Nebraska off and running. And then Turner Gill comes back with his third touchdown pass of the afternoon. This time he just dumps it off to Phil Bates. And Bates is in there, 28-0. Nebraska over the Buffaloes. Once again, Essington was intercepted by Krajcik. And then Gill wasted no time. The first play after the interception goes to Todd Brown. Touchdown, Nebraska. They lead at this point, 35-0. Late third period action now. Mike Moravec caps off the scoring. A 7-yard run, 59-0. The Huskers win it. The next week, it was off to Kansas State, where they beat the Wildcats 49-3. Husker quarterback Turner Gill turned in another fine performance. First series of downs for Nebraska. Here he picks up a first down and 17 yards to boot. Couple of plays later, looks for tight end Jamie Williams over the middle. It's good for a 23-yard touchdown pass. And early in the first period, Nebraska has a 7-0 lead. Later in the first period, this twosome, Turner Gill to Jamie Williams, was to click again. This time, good for an 11-yard touchdown pass, a beautiful combination. Jamie Williams, two touchdown passes on the day. Mike Rozier had 153 yards rushing that sunny day in Manhattan, Kansas. This 93-yard touchdown run, indicative of the kind of afternoon the Cornhuskers had as they rolled to a 49-3 win over the Wildcats to take a 2-0 record in the Big 8. It was a tough day indeed for Nebraska at Missouri before they beat the Tigers by the score of 6-0. Big play here. Turner Gill to Irving Fryer. First down at midfield. But you know what? Three plays later, Nebraska is still at midfield. Third down. Turner Gill looking for Todd Brown. He has him, and Todd Brown takes it to the 27 of Missouri. The Huskers really on a roll now. Again, another big play for the Huskers. Gill again looking for Todd Brown. He's got it at the 10, takes it inside the 5 to the 4. With 26 seconds left in the game, the score was still tied. Nothing, nothing. Third and goal, Phil Bates goes up the middle on the trap play. Nebraska beats Missouri by a score of 6-0. They are now 3-0 in Big 8 play. Nebraska came home to play Kansas and win their fourth consecutive Big 8 game, 31-15. And with Nebraska leading a close one, 17-15 over the Jayhawks, it was Turner Gill to Jamie Williams. That made it 24-15. Nebraska with some breathing room. And then Mike Rozier gave the Huskers all the room they needed. He goes 49 yards on this touchdown run as the Cornhuskers wrapped up their fourth consecutive Big 8 win, the final, Nebraska 31, Kansas 15. Then it was off to Stillwater, Oklahoma to play the Cowboys of Oklahoma State. And Nebraska simply exploded in that game. They scored 28 third period points to go along with scattered touchdowns along the way to beat the Oklahoma State Cowboys 54-7. Another good day for Turner Gill and company. Finally, Nebraska made it 6-0 in the Big 8 Conference as they took on the Iowa State Cyclones. Again, it was a close game, and again, it was broken wide open by the kicking game. Irving Fryer returns a punt 63 yards for a touchdown as Nebraska scores 24 points in a five-minute span of the fourth period of that game. They win it 31-7 over the Cyclones, and Nebraska takes a 6-0 Big 8 record into the game against Oklahoma, of course already having wrapped up the Big 8 championship. The Oklahoma Sooner Band is on the field now here at Owens Stadium. And you know, Oklahoma this year, not a good year. 3-1-1 in the Big 8. The Sooners, however, can help salvage the year by upsetting Nebraska today, then winning their final game against Oklahoma State next Saturday, and then posting a victory in the Sun Bowl, a bowl bid that they hope to receive later this afternoon. Now, earlier this week, I had a chance to visit with some of the Oklahoma players, and they say their first order of business is to beat Nebraska today.
You know, we still have a lot of pride in ourselves, and we're going to come out and play the very best game we can. And, you know, it'd make our season a whole lot better to, you know, come out and beat Nebraska. You know, having a bad season like we've had, still going ahead and beat Nebraska, you know, it just makes you feel that much better about your season. So we're going to give it our all.
Well, I feel that more or less we're disappointed that we can't go to an Orange Bowl, but we feel that more or less our best thing for us to do is beat Nebraska and not let them go there knowing that they would just win outright champs and for to disappoint their season, more or less.
We might be a little down by losing last week, but
we're going to go out and give it the best shot that we can and approach this game the best way that we can, and hopefully we'll come out a winner.
Well, at first it was one that we were kind of hurt from Missouri. We had to get ourselves up for this football game because we know if we go out here and just lead off in Nebraska, they're just going to run all over. So we know we have to go out here and fight come Saturday. Well, I think this year we had a lot of inconsistency. I mean, we lost some games we shouldn't have lost. We had a lot of fumbles and a lot of mental mistakes, and we just couldn't really get it going together at a couple of times this season. Uh-huh. But we're going to try to come out here Saturday and just play like Oklahoma is, you know, known for playing, no fumbles, no mistakes and stuff like that.
I feel like we have a pretty decent offensive unit, period. We have great linemen up front, and then we have the backs that can run the ball and can get outside with their speed and quickness. So I feel like we have a pretty good offensive unit, period.
Do the Sooners doubt themselves at all after the season you've had so far, or you still have the confidence that you are a good, solid football team?
Well, I tell you this, we have the confidence we can beat Nebraska.
Mm-hmm. As you face Nebraska defensively, what do you think you have to do to stop the Cornhuskers?
Well, I think a lot of it's going to be right there on the line of scrimmage. We're going to have to whip the line of scrimmage. Our nose guard's going to have to take care of their center, which is supposed to be one of the best in America. You know, he's going to have a tough job. Me and the other defensive tackle's going to have to do a heck of a job.
It looks like your offense really can move the football. Your problem that day, obviously, was turnovers.
Yes, it was turnovers. That's why our season's been going all year long. We never really began a chance of getting anything established. And, you know, our turnovers this year just hurt us. Just heard our record, and you can tell by our record.
I know that Nebraska gets up for this game, and we also get up for this game. This is usually the game that decides the Big 8 championship, and it means so much to everyone. So I feel like we're going to go out and still approach it, look at it that way, and just get after it.
How do the coaches, Tom Osborne and Barry Switzer, feel about today's game? We'll find out, so stay with us. More to come on 7TV. You know, Tom Osborne and Barry Switzer both have different philosophies on coaching football, but they both agree that today's game is extremely important no matter what the records would say. Here's what those two coaches had to say about the game.
I think athletically, Oklahoma is very much like they've always been. They have a lot of good athletes, have a lot of team speed. I think that they feel and felt before the season began that their offensive line might be as good as they've ever had. I think that they had some uncertainty at quarterback, much as we did. And I believe that they feel very much about Darrell Shepard as we have about Turner Gill, that he's played very well for them in the last five, six, 7 weeks. They have excellent talent in their backfield. I think Stanley Wilson is probably the best fullback that they've ever had. I think Buster Rhymes probably has as much talent and as much potential as anybody they've had, and you know, they've had some great backs. I think he's been hurt a little bit this year, maybe hasn't had quite the year overall that he'd like to have. And I'm sure they'll miss Chet Winters at one running back, but they have some other good players there. So I think offensively, they're very comparable to what they have been in the past.
What about Nebraska, especially? What about Nebraska without Turner Gill? Do you think that'll make a difference to them?
Well, their style of offense, losing a quarterback always hurts you. But losing a quarterback in their style of offense doesn't hurt you nearly as much as losing a quarterback in our offense, because they still, any quarterback can turn and hand them eye backs about 40 times a game, and that's what they win with. They hammer with those two great backs they got. They got backs that look like they should be playing at Oklahoma, and they're our type of player.
Yeah. This one may not be for the Big 8 championship, but it certainly is for something. I know you're shooting for a bowl game, and a lot of pride involved here.
That's more the pride than anything. I think that Nebraska feels this way. You know, they've won the Big 8, and they're going to Orange Bowl, but they've got to beat Oklahoma to make it complete, and I know that they have to feel that way, and our team will play for pride, and you know, it's a big game. We're playing here at home. We like to play well. We like to play Nebraska, and you know, and I think we hold on to football, it'll be a good ball game.
Defensively, they're probably a little bit younger and less experienced than they have been, and that they have five or six sophomore players playing there. But I think they have very talented athletes. They've got a lot of speed, a lot of athletic ability. And after 10 games, you really don't have anyone that's a rookie anymore. You know, they've got some experience. So their defense is good. I think their kicking game is good. I think Nebraska and Oklahoma rank 1-2 in almost any order in almost all of the kicking stats in the league in terms of punt returns and kickoff returns and net punting and so on. So the kicking game, I think, will be a critical factor.
One final question. If Tom Osborne, you know, when he has an off year, losing three games or something like that, seems like the whole world's on his back. How has it been for Barry Switzer this year among the Oklahoma fans?
Well, Tom and I look at that kind of ridiculous. I do myself. I don't worry about it. A lot of times what those people sit in those stands say is really insignificant to me. That really doesn't matter. There are about six or seven people that I am responsible to and that Tom's responsible to, and those are the ones that determine whether we have a job or not. It's not those people sitting right there.
I think that football is football, and you go out there and play the best you can, and if you have a better team and you execute better, then you win. And if you don't, you lose. And so that's kind of the way I look at this game, and I think it'll be a very interesting game. I think it'll be a very tight game, and I think that both teams have some excellent athletes. And I think both of them, it doesn't make much difference whether the Orange Bowl has already been decided and the conference championship has been decided. I think once the ball is teed up and kicked off, that nobody thinks about those things. They just think about playing one play at a time and playing the best they can. So I think it'll be a very hard-fought ball game.
Well, the fun's about ready to begin here in Norman, Oklahoma. We'll be back with a kickoff for you, so stay with us on 7TV.
NCAA football, Nebraska versus Oklahoma, is brought to you by Renza, Nebraska Furniture Mart, the Walston Bank, True Value Hardware, Xena, and Northwestern Bell.
Well, both teams are back on the field now, getting ready for the kickoff here. And Bob, I guess we really can expect a pretty close game today.
It should be a good ball game. On all the prediction sheets, they say that this is about a toss-up ball game, so it should be that way. And I think it's going to depend a lot on which team plays the most air-free football.
All righty, and we're going to be back with the kickoff for you right after this. Back there and finally brought down, so he is at the 11-yard line. Make that the 21-yard line, so Oklahoma, and they now move it back to the 20, and so Oklahoma will start first and 10 from their own 20-yard line. Wayne Gazoo back with Bob Devaney. I tell you, Bob, we just got back in time for that one.
Right. You know, Nebraska's kicking game has been good all year, and our coverage of kicks has been good. And this was an example right here. We have Oklahoma starting the ball on their own 20.
Darryl Shepherd is the quarterback. Boy, he has come on very strong this year. He has been something else. And off to Wilson, Stanley. Wilson not too big, but he's elusive. 30, 40, 41-yard line.
Stanley Wilson is the guy, along with Darryl Shepherd, we have got to stop. This is the basis of the Sooner offense, and on the very first play, the fullback just busts through there. Wilson busts through there for a first down.
Well, on this run, Stanley Wilson goes over 2,000 yards for his career here at the University of Oklahoma. Rodney Lewis coming up from behind to make the tackle on Stanley Wilson. First and 10 for Oklahoma, ball at their own 41-yard line.
Oklahoma's in a true wishbone this time.
Shepherd keeps. Big hole. Down to the 41-yard line of Nebraska.
And on the first two plays, there's something happened that we didn't want to happen. First the fullback, and then Shepherd, the quarterback, has carried the ball for first down.
Jimmy Williams taken out of the play there, and you see there's nobody out there. Rich Lindquist comes up. Shepherd, a good move on him, but he does make the tackle. Again, a first down. Two first downs in a row for the Sooners.
Oklahoma split. Their left end split to left. And a power play this time.
Alvin Ross is the man. He replaces Chet Winters, who was injured in the Missouri game. And he's got another first down.
This is a thing, Wayne, that we can't have happen. It's just a power play with two blockers ahead of the ball carrier, and he rips up through that middle for a first down.
Inside the 30, let's call it the 29-yard line, as Tom Osborne looks on. They break out of the wishbone. Hand up right up the middle, Stanley Wilson, and he gets six.
The Oklahoma team is getting off the ball tremendously quick. This Oklahoma line is off that ball real quick, and they just seem to take the ball. They're going on a quick count. They just seem to be taking the game to us at this point. That defense has got to dig in.
Second down and 3.5, 4 yards to go. Again, it's Alvin Ross. He gets down to the 20-yard line. That'll be just shy of a first down.
Oklahoma's in four down territory here, so they have two downs to make about a yard.
I think the Oklahoma Sooners record really not indicative of the kind of talent that they have here, because at the beginning of the year, Bob, I know Barry and company felt that they could be very good.
Well, they certainly look at the start of the game. They're running from a wishbone sometimes and then from kind of a wing bone where they have only two backs. Now they got two tight ends in there.
Shepard still has it. The pitch out to Rhymes. And Rhymes is in for the touchdown. Buster Rhymes, who played havoc with Nebraska a year ago, is starting early here. Nobody was around him.
Well, this is one of those plays that we didn't have a guy defensing the wide man down the field. And the pitch out, Shepard to Rhymes, and there was really nobody in position to make the tackle here. Rhymes is all alone. Reminds a little of that play he ran down the sideline a year ago to set up the winning touchdown.
Mike Keeling in makes it 7-0 Oklahoma. So with 12 minutes and 41 seconds to go in the first period, the score, Oklahoma 7, Nebraska nothing. The Oklahoma Sooners looking impressive. The first time they had the football, they went 80 yards in only six plays. Buster Rhymes scoring, and it is 7-0 Oklahoma.
Nebraska now receiving the kickoff. And they're definitely under some pressure here offensively now. Oklahoma's all fired up, but we've got to come back and we've got to take the battle to them and try to get some first downs here, hold on to the football and get that tide to change.
Mike Keeling, number 99, will be kicking off for Oklahoma to either Anthony Steeles or Mike Rozier. It goes to Steeles at the 1 yard line. 10. And he's hit right there, bounces away from one man, and gets back out to about the 14-yard line before he's swarmed under.
And this Oklahoma team is keyed up. You can tell the way a team covers kicks, especially that kickoff. They were down there very fast. You can see Anthony Steeles does a good job of bouncing off of one tackler here, and he probably gets about three extra yards this way, but he stopped on the 15.
Well, the man who came in there first was Berrien Walker, defensive back, and he made the first hit. That slowed things up. They did give him out to the 15-yard line. So the Huskers starting at their own 15. Mark Maurer at quarterback, replacing the injured Turner Gill.
In the first play, the I-back takes the ball, Rozier, and he's met right at the line of scrimmage.
A couple of yards. That's about it. It'll be second down and 9. Mark Maurer put into a very difficult situation, Bob, where he started out the year as the number one quarterback, lost the job to Turner Gill, and now he's back in there because of a leg injury.
Right. Now, Mark knows he's got to do the job himself today, and he should be a little looser and should come on well here.
Pitch to Rozier. Good defensive coverage, but Mike makes a nice cut to get about 2 yards, but that'll bring up a long third down, and let's call it 5.
Nebraska's been running out of a winged eye formation with the left end split in both of these downs. And it's a question now whether they'll try to put that ball in the air down in this section of the field or not, or whether they will run a safer type play and figure out if they don't make it to kick it.
49 Jackie Schiff made the stop on Rozier the last time. Third and 5.5. Ball at the 18. Maurer looking to throw it. Castile's in the flat, right after the Rozier. He's got the first down. He's down the sideline. Team may break it. 50-yard line pushed out of bounds. Mike Rozier, a fine run.
There's a great, great, great call here by Tom Osborne. This just took a lot of courage. You're down your own end of the field, and this was an excellent call, and it's very well executed. And this could put us back in the ball game. Good blocking out here. Rozier follows his blocking and stays on his feet. And gets down here, almost breaks loose.
He had one man to beat, and I'll tell you, he just couldn't do it. Gary Lowell, the man who made the saving tackle. So Nebraska now with the ball at midfield, first and 10. Right at the middle of Rozier. Maybe one, maybe two.
We're back out of that end, the bad end of the field. We're down into Oklahoma territory now. And you can do about anything here. You can run your whole offense here without worrying too much. And that one was a real big play. One of the biggest plays of the season for us, that bringing that ball out of that area of the field.
A lot of people I talked to here in Norman during the week said they felt Nebraska probably had to open up the game against Oklahoma.
Yeah, I think they do, and they did on that play. And here's a play that looks like it might go.
Rozier inside the 40. That's a first down to the 39-yard line. So Nebraska picks up another first down.
It's an excellent job of open field running by Mike Rozier there. He could have been tackled right on the line of scrimmage.
Rozier comes into this game averaging 6.6 yards per carry. He's got 838 yards. Matter of fact, if Rozier has a tremendous day, he could go over that 1,000-yard mark, as could Roger Craig. He's up at 958 yards.
Roger and Mike are both excellent eye backs.
Rozier right at the line of scrimmage. No gain at all.
Well, we're into that situation again now, Wayne, where Tom will have to have them put the ball in the air here. They come up with a great play on third and long before. They've got third and about 9 or 10 here, and they've got to come up with a big play here.
Now we're down at second and 9, and Rozier now has carried the ball 5 times. He's gained only 15 yards, so he's half of what he normally is on per average carry.
Right.
Maurer. Pitch out to Rozier. Roger Craig. Craig's in the 30 down to about the 26-yard line. That would be good for a first down. Roger Craig, as I mentioned, at 958 yards coming into this game.
Roger Craig does an excellent job. Roger was, of course, got a lot of preseason All-American ratings, and you can see the reason here. He does a fine job of running and getting that extra yard for the first down.
So Nebraska, putting on a drive of its own, hasn't been as quick as Oklahoma's was, but so far it has indeed been effective. Ball at the Oklahoma 27-yard line. Power up the middle. Phil Bates, first time he's handled the ball, inside the 25 to the 23.
Bates is a fine inside runner, and he goes straight ahead about as good as any fullback we've ever had. There's Oklahoma man down on the field here.
Bates has 480 yards rushing so far this year, and he has got them at most opportune times. For instance, we're talking about that game against Missouri. So with timeout here on the field, it's 9 minutes 12 seconds to play in the first period to score. Oklahoma 7, Nebraska nothing. Steve Whitty, number 57, was the Oklahoma player shaken up. He did, however, leave the field under his own power, so he will probably return to the game later on. We have a second down now and about 7 yards to go for Nebraska. The ball resting at the 24-yard line of Oklahoma. The Huskers trying to drive it home. Maurer looking to throw.
And Maurer was in trouble there. It was a screen pass to the left, and Oklahoma read the screen very well, and Maurer very wisely threw the ball in the direction of the player to save intentional grounding. Maurer did a very fine job there. People probably don't realize it, but he saved us about 15 yards right there on that execution.
Number 53, Orlando Flanagan, was a man who was giving him an awful lot of pressure coming over from that left side. So big third down play. Third and 6. Have to get to the 18-yard line for a first down. Roger Craig, medical line of scrimmage, gets down to the 21-yard line, but it's going to be 3 yards short of the first down.
And we see the field goal unit coming on the field here.
Rick Bryan, number 80, top player on his team for Oklahoma, just kind of stays in there, puts his head down, and finds Craig. Eddie Neal setting it up.
He had a 37-38-yard field goal, I believe, Wayne.
He'll place it at the 28-yard line, a 38-yard attempt. What wind there is, it's about 5 to 10 miles per hour, is directly to Eddie Neal's back, so he's got that as a help. It's low, but it's long enough, and it is good. So Eddie Neal gets Nebraska on the scoreboard with 8:19 to go in the first period. Our score, Oklahoma 7, Nebraska 3. That was a 12-play scoring drive for Nebraska, culminated by a 38-yard field goal from Eddie Neal. So it's 7-3, the Sooners, and Kevin Seibel will be kicking it off either to Alvin Ross or Buster Rhymes. And I think the key question now is, can Nebraska stop that wishbone? They certainly couldn't the first time Oklahoma had the ball.
You know, Wayne, it was very important that we got on the board down there, though. That was a real important drive, because when you get down into scoring territory, you don't come away with anything. It hurts. But getting that 3 points puts us back now where a touchdown will put us in the lead. And that was a fine kick by Seibold. So Oklahoma once more starts on their 20-yard line.
And a key play in that Nebraska drive you can't overlook was the fact that Maurer did not get sacked by Orlando Flanagan. He threw the ball towards Roger Craig, but into the ground. And that was a key play because it saved Nebraska 15 yards, kept them in field goal range.
Right. They couldn't weren't in range without that. Now Oklahoma's lined up in a wing formation here now.
Little mix up in the backfield. Buster Rhymes has it. Nebraska chasing him, and finally Sammy Sims is the one that brings him down. So Darrell Shepard and Buster Rhymes had a little problem in the backfield. Loss of a yard. We'll see what happens.
There definitely was a mistake here. Somebody went the wrong way, and it looks like it might have been Rhymes. But this is the kind of thing we hope that Oklahoma will do occasionally, because when they're not making mistakes, they're a real, real tough outfit to stop. But mistakes have kind of helped the opposition this year.
In past years, they've made the fumbles, but they've overcome those mistakes. Against Missouri, for instance, they just gave the ball away 9 times, and they were never really able to overcome those mistakes. So it is second down and 11. Wilson. And that's the first time they've gotten to Stanley Wilson. Jeff Krejci up from his defensive back spot.
Oklahoma running from two split ends that time, and it's a real good job by the right side of Nebraska's line over there. They piled Wilson up. That's, as you said, that's the first time they really slowed him down.
Brent Evans was the man who made the first hit on Wilson. Third down and 7.
We'll see if Oklahoma will go to the air.
Well, they're the leading rushing team in the country. They like to run that ball. And just like that, Darrell Shepard breaks the wave of Nebraska tacklers, has a first down out to the 33-yard line.
And the ironical part that time, we had that play pretty well defense, but there was a missed tackle just past the line of scrimmage that you're going to see here, right there. Right, I think that's Dan Kroger that had a shot at him and missed, and he got the first down. But I think we had to play defense well as just execution.
Shepard has run for 717 yards this year, and every time he touches the ball, he almost averages 7 yards a carry. Stanley Wilson, about 3 yard gain that time.
And Oklahoma is an example of, just as you said, Wayne, they get in long yardage down, they think run instead of pass, and they come up with a big running play with long yardage a couple plays ago, and now they're in normal yardage again, and they can do almost anything, but I look for them to kind of keep that ball on the ground as long as they're moving it.
Second down and 7, and they certainly will. They're most attempted passes they made this year was 19, that against Missouri, and they had their backs against the wall early in that one. Look at Stanley Wilson. He just gets a first down out to the 47-yard line. He's not that big.
Wilson is one real fine fullback. He's one of the better fullbacks that Oklahoma's had. They've had some good ones, but you can see his power right here. He's hit, and he just carries right on for an extra 5 yards after he's hit.
So Stanley Wilson right now having himself a good game, and it seems so far that Nebraska having an extremely difficult time doing anything against this wishbone of Oklahoma. Alvin Ross, another big hole. He's inside Nebraska territory at the 48-yard line.
It seems like that Oklahoma line is getting off there, seem to be getting to us, and the backfield are getting to the line of scrimmage without any breakthrough by our line. The Oklahoma line appears a lot quicker than I thought they were. They really get off that ball in a hurry.
As Alvin Ross, just a freshman out of Aurora, Illinois, 6'1", 195 pounds. He is the man who is replacing Chet Winters, who was hurt against Missouri. Wilson, down to the 44-yard line.
It's close, but I don't think it's a first down. It's pretty close, but it's third down.
Here we see the Nebraska linebacking corps, Brent Evans. Brent Evans, the one that got in there and filled the gap. Third down one now for the Sooners. The way they've been going, this should be almost no problem for them.
Well, the thing is, Wayne, I'm afraid if they don't make it this down, they're going to try it again the fourth down. I think this is the one we want to watch for, that big play that somebody don't pop.
Ross, he's going to be awful close.
It was a good job defensively, again, by the right side of our line and our linebackers over there. It was a good job, but he didn't have far to go.
By the way, Stanley Wilson's carried the ball six times. Now he already has 47 yards. First down for the Sooners. So Oklahoma on the march again.
Stanley Wilson getting up pretty slow there.
Ball's at the 42 in Nebraska. And the Huskers still trying to find a way to stop this wishbone attack. Darrell Shepard, a quarterback. Stanley Wilson, Alvin Ross, and Busta Rhymes in there at halfback. Shepard keeps it to the 35-yard line. 7-yard gain, second and three for Oklahoma.
Second down, three.
Once more, you see Shepard coming down the line of scrimmage here. There's some good blocking in there. I believe that's Sammy Sims that finally makes the tackle, but it's after a 7-yard gain.
Well, Oklahoma decides to call timeout here, and of course you see Shepard down there limping a little bit. Have to look at him. Kelly Phelps, of course, is the man who would replace him, number seven, if Shepard was hurt. But Shepard came on after the first couple of games and has been doing a tremendous job. Want to remind you that you can, of course, see all the highlights of today's game on NewsWatch 7 Update. We'll also have all the scores for all the games played today as well at that time. So, later today.
And Wayne, it looks like Shepard has got an ankle injury. He is being removed, I believe, from the ball game here. He's limping quite badly over in the sideline. He's walking a little faster than he was there, but it looks like either an ankle or a knee. Looks like his left ankle.
Well, changing quarterbacks now, and of course, the number seven quarterback will be Kelly Phelps to run the attack.
Well, Kelly Phelps earlier in the year played a lot of quarterback. He got a lot of experience, but he not played as much in the last few games. Shepard has more or less taken over the job. But Phelps is in here now. He's and I hope that maybe that change in quarterbacks here will have a little adverse effect, you might say, for the Cornhuskers. So they can come up with some plays here because Shepard had really been running that ball very effectively.
Well, the whole Oklahoma team is definitely running that wishbone as the wishbone was meant to be run with the kind of talent that they have. And so far, they haven't put the ball on the ground, which I think has amazed 75,000 people here because they've been doing that with their...
There it is.
And it's going to be Nebraska recovering, and the Huskers get it at the 25. And just as we mentioned it, this has been the problem all year. Rodney Lewis gets the turnover, the first for the Oklahoma Sooners of the game. And Nebraska had the ball at their own 26-yard line.
It looked like the center, the ball either hit the quarterback's knee or he kicked the football. It hit his foot because it went 10 yards past the line of scrimmage to where Lewis was able to recover it.
Let's see how it happened here. Never got it.
Or somebody else kicks the ball that goes by. The guard pulling hit the ball.
That happens so often. He never got the snap. New quarterback in there. First play, a problem. Here's the pitch out. Rozier cuts up. Out across the 30 to the 31-yard line. Pick up of five. We look into the Nebraska defensive and offensive huddles. They're trying to find a way to make sure they can stop Oklahoma because I'm sure they're not depending on a fumble every time.
Well, Nebraska, I think right now, has got to think of getting that ball down the field and getting a touchdown. If we get out here ahead, I think it'll mean a lot. I think we get out here, if we can score on this drive, it could be a great help.
Todd Brown, wide to the right of your screen. That's Irving Fryer in motion. Pitch goes to Rozier up the middle.
And this is a big third down play coming up, Wayne. It's third and about three. And we can get this first down, keep some momentum going here. Otherwise, we're going to have to punt to Oklahoma. But our kicking game has been good. So we'll hope that we can get the first down first.
Third down three. As we said, a beautiful day for football in Norman, Oklahoma. The temperature expected to get up near 60 degrees. The winds are light and variable, maybe 10 miles an hour at the most. And a blue Oklahoma sky overhead. Third down three. Power. Complete. And that is to Anthony Steele. First down, Nebraska.
Mauer looked good. He drilled that ball in there, really drilled it in there. And he did a good job of maneuvering before he threw it. Here's Dave Remington is blocking off the ball, and Dave does a good job here. He's the guy that's playing against Dave, this Lewis, is one of the finest defensive middle guards in college football, at least in the Big Eight, and Remington did a good job on Lewis that play.
Rozier getting a breather. Roger Craig in there at I-back right now. Phil Bates, a fullback. You see Todd Brown to the bottom of your screen, up the middle. And Craig, maybe a yard or two.
This Oklahoma defense has not been real effective this year, but so far in this ball game, they have played real tough when they've had to. And I think we're going to have to keep, as we did there, throwing the ball occasionally to keep the defense loose.
This is a very young Oklahoma defense. They start 7 sophomores and a freshman. So they're going to be around for a long time to come. Phil Bates, big hole. Into Oklahoma territory, he's brought down finally at the 46-yard line, and that'll be extremely close to a first down and a 2nd-and-8 play. Here we see that Oklahoma defense and how they reacted to Phil Bates. You can see, nice block by Steele.
Real fine block by Anthony Steele. And Phil Bates slid off to the left that time, and he's probably one of the most underrated runners we've had at that fullback spot. He runs tough.
It was a first down, so the Huskers with the ball on the Oklahoma 46-yard line. 1:30 to go here in the first quarter. It's 7-3 Oklahoma. Oklahoma scored in 6 plays. Look at a reverse. Read very well, and that was Mike Pruitt who read that one.
That was one of those plays that can make a bunch of yards, or it could backfire. And that time, as you mentioned, the defensive right end of Oklahoma is not fooled on the play.
Look at Truett coming there.
Comes right in there, and the play is stopped. Number 41, number 38 on that play. And now we're in a long yardage situation again.
Back to midfield, 2nd down, 14. Maurer looking to pass it. Truett giving some pressure. He's got it off to Roger Craig. Breaks one tackle and is wrestled out of bounds at the 41-yard line. That'll be shy of a first down, but it gets them some very much-needed yardage. It'll put them in kind of a 3rd down and maybe 4 situation.
And Wayne, that time, Maurer got real fine protection. He had all the time he needed to pick his receiver. And this will help our passing game a lot. If we can give Maurer a chance to throw that ball, he's a good passer. And that time, we did give him fine protection.
Albert Watts, the freshman, 6'2", 195 pounds. Chasing Craig out of there. So 3rd down and 5. Maurer, the hesitation, the pitch out. Roger Craig, 1st down for Craig.
And this is the play that everybody was kind of waiting to see if Mark Maurer could run as well. This is been one of our key plays with Turner Gill in the lineup. And this time, Mark Maurer had that handle that option play real well. His timing was perfect.
You see Watts come up, get taken out. So a 1st down for Nebraska. The ball just inside the 35. Let's call it the 34 of Oklahoma. The Huskers again controlling the ball with 30 seconds to go in the first quarter. They trail 7-3, but they are moving the football. Up the middle, Craig, nowhere to go. Maybe a yard. And a flag goes down. Let's see what it's going to be.
It's in the Oklahoma secondary. We'll have to wait and see here.
Personal foul against Oklahoma. I didn't see exactly what happened, but it happened about 2 seconds after the play was completed. Craig was on the ground, and it happened in the secondary, so apparently some punches were either thrown, but it's going to cost Oklahoma 15 yards, give Nebraska a 1st down near inside the 20 at the 19-yard line.
And Wayne, this is a crucial penalty. There's an Oklahoma defensive back, a necessary roughness, and it keeps our drive going, gets us in 4 down and scoring situation.
19 seconds to go, first period. 15-yard penalty, not pleasing to the crowd here of 75,000 on hand at Oklahoma Memorial Stadium. The field itself, Owen Field. In motion, Irving Pryor. Pitch out to Craig. He's got some running room outside. 15, 10, 5, touchdown, Roger Craig.
He did a great job of blocking on the outside. It was a very It was very well. It was a great call, and the blocking on the outside there was tremendous. Roger Craig ran the ball. He had only one man to beat going into the end zone, and it puts Nebraska out on top here. With just 2 seconds left in the first quarter, and it looks like Kevin Seibel to kick the extra point.
Jackie Shipp was the last man who could have got him, and Roger Craig just goes in there. Craig now, 6 carries, 43 yards and a touchdown. The kick by Seibel is good, and so Nebraska has taken a 10-7 lead, and I guarantee you we probably haven't seen the last of the scoring from either team today. It appears it may be a day of offenses, not so much so for the defenses.
You know, the funny thing about it is, Wayne, back in 1971, we came down here expecting a defensive battle. It ended up 35-31. Nobody could stop anybody, and this might be the same thing today.
There you see Mark Maurer, Roger Craig on the sidelines. He has stuck with it through thick and thin, had his problems, a lot of fumbles early in the year. Got a bad name. Hi, Mom, Roger Craig. 2 seconds to go here in the first quarter. The Huskers have taken the lead, 10-7. Looked impressive, and taking that ball in there helped out by a 15-yard personal foul call against the Oklahoma Sooners.
You know, it's good to see Roger Craig carrying that football with confidence. For a while there, Roger was fumbling the ball. I think he was losing a little confidence in himself. But lately, he's been holding on that football, and he's a great runner. And that touchdown, I'm certain, does him a lot of good.
Once again, Kevin Seibel will key it up. It'll be Alvin Ross and Buster Rhymes. So far, Nebraska and Oklahoma total yardage. Nebraska 138 yards, Oklahoma 134. So Nebraska has negated that opening drive of Oklahoma.
If they keep on like this, both teams will have about 500 yards of total yardage.
Well, we've got the number one and the number two rushing teams in the country. Rhymes will down it, bring it out to the 20-yard line, where let's see if Daryl Shepard will be coming out. Remember on the last series for Oklahoma, Daryl Shepard was injured. He was limping. And, of course, 2 seconds still showing on the scoreboard clock here in the first quarter.
That change in quarterback that first time was a disastrous thing for Oklahoma because Nebraska went down and scored his go-ahead touchdown after the fumble.
Well, Shepard is back. Kelly Phelps had one play, fumbled it, and that was it. Stanley Wilson, look, he got hit at the line of scrimmage. He still gets two.
I have a feeling, though, our defense here, they have not been playing well, but they are coming on.
Well, that's the end of the first quarter here in Norman, Oklahoma with the score. The Nebraska Cornhuskers 10, the Oklahoma Sooners 7. Roger Craig, who is having himself a tremendous afternoon so far. He's got 43 yards rushing and only 6 attempts, getting some attention on the sidelines. Second down and 8 for the Oklahoma Sooners from their 21-yard line. Shepard pitches it out to Alvin Ross. Ross is hit there by Rodney Lewis and Jeff Krejci. He gets close to the 25, make it the 24-yard line. It'll be 3rd and 6.
At that time, we defensed that option play very well. We played the fullback, the quarterback, and the pitch. There's a gain of 2 yards on the play. It puts Oklahoma in a situation where they don't want to be. They're 3rd and long yardage. They don't like to throw the ball. So I think you can look for another run here. At least they have not put the ball in the air yet.
If they have to go to the air, I think Nebraska will be in great shape because Shepard cannot throw, but he can run. Gets the first down to the 31.
And that's the same play Shepard used to gain the first down the last time on long yardage. He just faked the ball to the fullback, and he kept it.
We'll see it again, and I think you'll see Steve Danproger making the final stop on him. Shepard limping a little bit again.
Shepard is limping. At the halftime, that could stiffen up on him because he is limping.
Shepard now has carried the ball 4 times. He has 43 yards, so he's a little bit more than 10 yards every time he touches the football. Ross.
That's about the 3rd type of play they ran. They run the option where they give the ball to Wilson, where Shepard keeps it, and then that power play to the right halfback going to his left have been very effective against us. And then, of course, the one time they did pitch it out on the option, it was a touchdown.
Danproger made the stop, but it was a gain of 4 yards. It'll bring up a 2nd down and 6 at the 35-yard line of Oklahoma. Shepard, he'll keep it.
And he's brought down by Jeff Krejci.
Now, Shepard is complaining about something to the official there. I don't know what he's hollering about. It looked like a pretty clean tackle and everything, but he was complaining. I think Shepard's hurting. I think he's hurting, and Oklahoma needs Shepard. You can see him out here. You'll see the play, and it looks like a very fine tackle.
Good one-on-one performance by Krejci. That might be what he was complaining about there.
One of the linebackers come over the top, but I don't think he really hit him.
Third down. Let's call it 2.5 to 3. Ball at the 38. Wilson.
And it's awfully close to a first down. I'm afraid he made it. Oklahoma had some wide splits in their line there, and Wilson just curled into a hole over the right guard.
He got the first. Now, Sammy Wilson, I interviewed him on Wednesday, and I was really surprised. He's not all that tall. He's listed at about 5'11", but I am not 5'11", and he was just about a half inch shorter than I was, which surprised me, so we'll have to see.
He's not a big runner, but he's a good runner.
Shepard.
Now, there's the first time we really played the option well. That played very well that time. We got Shepard through him for about a 7-yard loss.
Nice play by Toby Williams.
Not a
good defensive effort.
About a 5-yard loss.
Shepard that time, you see, he fakes it off to Wilson, and nobody got Toby Williams, and he just kept running after Shepard and lassoed him. The ball back inside the 40 to the 38, second down and 15.
And one of these times, even though Oklahoma don't want to, I think they're going to have to put that ball in the air.
You know, Toby Williams, what a tough time he had at the beginning of the year, and now he started to come on strong last few games, having good. Shepard wants to go to the air. A little screen pass to Stanley Wilson. Wilson, nice move, and he's got some running room.
I tell you, Nebraska had that screen pass played almost perfectly. We had three fellas over on the side of the screen, yet Wilson broke loose, did a great job, a great individual job of running the football.
Stanley Wilson, we were talking about him not being big, but one thing you can't say about him is that he's slow.
Watch, here's two Nebraska Cornhuskers right here, and he slips to the outside.
He is shy of a first down, so it will be a third down and 3 at the 49-yard line.
And that was the first pass for Oklahoma, a screen pass complete to Stanley Wilson.
Wilson, he breaks it. He could be gone. No, he loses his balance, and he is out of bounds. But if he had held his balance, he could have gone all the way.
That's a great job of running by Wilson. He's really a workhorse, and he just burst through there that time. He seems to have tremendous acceleration. He's
big hole.
He runs like a fullback, yet he seems to have halfback speed.
We mentioned coming into this game, Stanley Wilson needed only 6 yards to break the 2,000 career mark for his efforts here at Oklahoma. Well, he's now got 74 yards and only 9 carries, so he's well past that.
And Oklahoma's threatening again. They're in the... they're down now. They almost got another. I think they may have another first down. They're down to about the 22-yard line.
Stanley Wilson is close again. He got at least 9 yards, and I think they're going to call it just shy of a first down at the 22-yard line. Has to get just inside the 22, so he's about 5 inches shy, and Wilson's going to get a breather.
Well, I'll bet you the ball don't go to the fullback this time if Wilson is not in there. I'd be surprised if they give it to anybody without him being in there right now, a new man. They didn't. They gave the ball to Shepard.
Shepard keeps the ball, gets the first down.
Right. It looked like we had that play diagnosed pretty well, that option, and then all of a sudden Shepard's out there running loose. But I do think he broke a tackle. I think that the defensive coaches are going to find when they check things at the half that there have been some missed tackles here that have made that quarterback play appear to be so effective.
Ball at the Nebraska 16.5-yard line. First down for Oklahoma. They've got their wishbone in gear today. Alvin Ross.
And that's the power play over the left side of their line. They're running into the strength of our formation. Our side, right side of that line is tough, and they seem to be running into it. They run this power play there. They've got two backs blocking in front of the right halfback.
Look at that wall.
Right, and it's a good job of blocking. Those Oklahoma backs appear to be good blockers.
Well, Jeff Krejci has been in an awful lot of tackles today, and that's not what a coach wants to hear, that his defensive backs are making tackles. Danny Wilson inside the 10. He'll get no more, but he'll be at the 9, and it'll bring a 3rd and 2.
Wilson was stopped for about a 2-yard gain that time, was played well, but they're down there. Oklahoma's down there now in that 4-yard, 4-down territory, and they're going to be going for that touchdown. They don't want to settle for a field goal in here.
10 minutes to go in the first half. Nebraska on top, 10-7. Sooners took the lead, 7-0. Eddie Neal came back with a 38-yard field goal, making it 7-3. Roger Craig took it in on a nice drive by Nebraska to make it 10-7, Nebraska. But now, the Sooners on a 3rd down and 3.
The two tight ends this time. They put the fullback in motion. There's the option play.
Alvin Ross.
Well played.
At the 10-yard line, so he lost about a half a yard, depending on where they mark it. A fine play there by Tony Felici and Brent Evans.
Now here's a crucial play. Do they go for the field goal, or do they try to make the first down? They're sending in four players here. It appears like it could be the field goal kicking unit.
I think it will be Mike Keeling coming in there. There you see Mike Keeling. He does all the kicking for them, be it punting, kickoffs, and the field goal attempts. He'll be teeing it up at about the 17-yard line, 27-yard attempt. Again, he's got a little breeze behind him. He's a good field goal kicker, but it's partially blocked, I believe, off to the right. No good.
And Nebraska escaped a bullet, you might say there. That's well within the field goal kicker's range.
So Oklahoma fails to score with 9:02 to go in the first half. The score, Nebraska 10, Oklahoma 7. Nebraska, first down at their own 20-yard line. The Huskers dodged the bullet, as Bob said a moment ago, and Mike Keeley missed a gimme for him anyway. Doug Wilkening out across the 25 to the 26-yard line. Gain of 6. It'll be 2nd and 4.
And Nebraska's line looked real aggressive that time. They came off the ball good, kicked Oklahoma's line out of there, and Wilkening was right straight up the middle. And if you can get that 5 or 6 yards on the first down, it makes those other downs a little easier.
At halftime, Clemson over South Carolina, 15-7. Boston College Rutgers tied 14-14 at the half. Southern Mississippi with a 3-0 win lead over Louisville. Head off, Rozier. First down, out to the 32-33-yard line. And Nebraska really running around the ends of Oklahoma.
This is a fine play. There was real good blocking. Again, on rather a delayed sweep. The quarterback comes back, hands the ball off deep to the I back. And here you see him going back there deep with Rozier swinging out with some blockers in front of him, and he's got some speed. He gets some good blocking here.
Nebraska first down out at their 33-yard line. By the way, Michigan has a 9-7 lead over Ohio State in the third period of play. Steals in motion. Roger Craig has it. He follows some blocking. He's out close to the 40-yard line, the 39. Pick up about 8 yards on the play. It'll bring 2nd and 2.5, maybe 3.
Anthony Steels, the wingback on the right side, went in the motion to the left that time and did a fine job blocking on the end of the line. You see, here comes Craig around the end here.
Jackie Schiff had him, but Craig carried him 4 yards. Roger Craig, good afternoon for this man. He's a tough runner. He runs with those knees going every which way. Again, it's Craig into the line. Breaks off one tackle. Still on his feet. 50, 49-yard line. What a day Roger Craig is having.
Roger goes down into, he's just inside Nebraska territory. And you watch Craig here. He does a tremendous job of running.
Just keeps it moving. And, you know, this is one of the reasons why he was fumbling a lot. He runs so hard, and he's just concentrating on running it. Sometimes that ball's out there, people can get it. Bob Slater finally gets the stop on Roger Craig.
Roger kept the ball in close to his body that time. Did a pretty good job. Now, here's a tough one. Oklahoma diagnosed this play here almost like it was a misplay.
Now, Craig did do a good job just getting back to the original line of scrimmage that time. Like he got his elbow on that turf down there. Doesn't look like it's too serious, but George Sullivan will come over and look at it and just tell him what it is. Craig now
Nine carries, 61 yards here in the first half for Roger Craig.
And the one good thing about that Nebraska backfield combination, if Roger isn't in there, Mike Rozier's in there, and they're both fine runners.
Doug Wilkening at fullback. Rozier at I-back. Maurer going to pass over the middle. It is complete. And that is Mitch Crank.
Mitch Crank is a guy that came in to fill in for a real fine tight end, Jamie Williams. He's done a great job. And that was a fine job of execution by Mark Bauer. And also, he got great protection. Plenty of time to throw the ball.
All the time in the world. Crank's right there. Good hands. He gets hit immediately. And he's got a first down for Nebraska at the 39. Rather make it the 44.
And the ability of Nebraska to throw the ball may be the difference in these two teams as the game goes along.
I get it right. It's the 34. Reverse, serving Fryer. And he's not going to go anyplace. Fryer just met, loss of the yard, back to the 35-yard line.
Well, the two reverses that Nebraska's tried, Oklahoma has diagnosed almost as if they had the play planned, like they had scouted the play.
Well, that's the second time Nebraska's tried that, and it just hasn't really worked too well. So it'll bring up a second down and 10.5.
Nebraska's got a wide split to the left. The two wide receivers out on the left side of the formation.
Off the middle. There's Mike Rozier. And Rozier inside the 25 to the 23-yard line. It should be a first down. First down, Nebraska. Look at the blocking on this play.
There's Doug Wilkening out there, puts in a good block. The line opens up a big hole for Rozier.
Good move there.
He breaks two tackles.
Gary Lowell finally coming over to make sure that he was down, but so far the offensive line in Nebraska really blocking here on this drive. Power. He'll keep it. Gets to the 20. Gain of 2. Second down and 8. 5:05 to go. First half.
Nebraska's running from two tight ends in their formation and a wing back now. They're trying to spread that defensive line of Oklahoma's out as much as they can.
Barry Switzer looking on. Has to be a bit concerned. Tom Osborne hoping to punch this one in and make it count.
Something here that Maurer wants to talk to Coach Osborne about.
So, timeout on the field. 4 minutes, 45 seconds to go. First half, our score, Nebraska 10 and Oklahoma 7. Again, a beautiful day here in Norman, Oklahoma. Tom Osborne looking on from the sidelines. You can see that blue sky here. It is a beautiful day. Temperature expected to be, that's probably around 55 degrees right now. A little breeze coming out of the southeast. It is the second down and 8 for Nebraska. The ball at the Oklahoma 20-yard line. Bates in at fullback. They hand it off to Irving Fryer. He pitches it out to Rozier, but he is out of bounds. Huskers just ran out of turf.
Right. It was a well-executed option play, but as you said, we didn't have enough room, so we gained about 3 on the play. Maybe 4 yards. It leaves us now with a third down and a long 4.
Just kind of ran out of territory that time. Couldn't get it there.
Right.
Third and 4. Ball on the 18. There's one of those key third down plays for Nebraska. Bates up the middle. Trap play. He's got the first down, and he
touchdown.
Gets the touchdown.
There's a great block. Dave Remington got off the ball that time. If you can see, if there is a replay on it, Dave Remington got off that ball as quick as I've ever seen a center get off there. He looked almost like he was offside. He got a key block, and they popped the fullback Bates right up the middle. This was hit by one man. A real well-executed play.
That's the play that got the touchdown at Missouri, and he gets the touchdown. Here he just cuts a little bit to his left. He's gone.
A great trap play by the middle of the Nebraska line.
16-7, Nebraska with the lead right now, and Kevin Seibel will try to make it 17-7. The end zone shot, the kick is up, and it is good. So, with 4 minutes and 35 seconds to go here in the first half, the score, Nebraska 17, Oklahoma 7.
And it looks...
Total offense right now, Nebraska has 218 yards, Oklahoma 204 yards. So statistically speaking, it would not indicate a 17-7 Nebraska lead, but indeed that is what the score reads.
And Oklahoma's got to fight from behind now. They've got to do something that they, it's difficult for just a running team to do. They've got to pick up here 10 points.
And Darrell Shepard may make me eat my words later, but he has not been able to pass this year. Buster Rhymes, he is going to be brought down by Jimmy Williams. And I want to tell you an interesting thing about Oklahoma this year, Bob. It's hard to believe, but the longest return on a kickoff for Oklahoma this year has been 31 yards. Buster Rhymes gathered it in at the one time, took it out to the 32, and that is it.
Well, Rhymes that time ran a rather undisciplined return. He started up into where his blocking was, and then he branched out into his own, and he lost about 7 yards. But it's another example of Nebraska's fine kicking game and the way they cover these kicks. It's a great job of coverage.
Ball on the 12-yard line, Oklahoma. Darrell Shepard, still a quarterback. He was hurt earlier, went out. Kelly Phelps came in for one play. Stanley Wilson, what a game this guy's having.
This Wilson is the finest opposing fullback we've run into this year. He's a tremendous runner, and he's got such quick acceleration. He gets that ball. He seems to be by the line of scrimmage before the defensive linebackers can react.
He is a yard shy of the first down. He now has 94 yards and just 12 carries for Stanley Wilson. Shepard, they need a yard for the first down. Buster Rhymes won't get it.
Don't have it.
Nice play by Nebraska's left side that time. Red Evans, Toby Williams, all of them in there on the tackle.
It seems to me, Wayne, that Nebraska is gradually defensing the wide stuff that Oklahoma is trying. They haven't entirely stopped Wilson up there. They haven't entirely stopped Shepard. But they have shut off the wide pitch out on the option play.
Third down and three. They've got to get just past the 28-yard line for a first down. Shepard strings it out. No. He is stopped. Jeff Krejci.
Real well played. They played that option real well. Krejci covered the quarterback, and they had a defensive back out there right with the pitch man, so there was no way Shepard could pitch the football.
Well, Jeff Krejci, watch out quick. He comes up from his defensive back spot. He's not going to fool anybody. He's just going to come after Shepard. So Oklahoma forced a punt on fourth and three. Mike Keeley will be back there. He'll be standing at about his 10-yard line. Gets the kick off. Irving Fryer will take it at the 28, 35, 40, and he is out to the 41-yard line.
And once more, Nebraska has good field position on their own 40. And Nebraska seems to be coming out of here with a lot of enthusiasm. The Oklahoma team has seemed to be moving on and off that field just a little slower than they were earlier in the game.
2 minutes, 37 seconds to go here in the first half from Owen Field, Oklahoma Memorial Stadium to be exact. It's 17-7, Nebraska with that 10-point lead. So Nebraska has the ball at their own 41-yard line. Good field position. Phil Bates is the fullback. Anthony Steele's the wingback. He is in motion now. Mark Mauert, quarterback. The pitch out. Roger Craig!
Nope, there's a flag. There's two flags on the play. And this looks like it could be a holding call against Nebraska. I'm not sure, but usually when the flag falls around that area of the field, it's an offensive holding call.
Indeed it is. And so this is the first penalty against Nebraska. They have played a very clean first half.
And these are the kind of things that you want to stay away from, because in college football, you're penalized here sometimes 15 yards on a play like this, and that really puts you in long yardage situation.
Well, now the officials are going to figure it out here. They have some question as to exactly what the situation is.
They're having a little conference here, and I hope maybe they can come up with a different call there as far as Nebraska's concerned.
Score out of Ames, Iowa in the second period, Oklahoma State 10. Iowa State nothing in the second period, Bob. So Oklahoma State going up there trying to get a win.
Right, and they're working. They're trying to get into a bowl game, as is Iowa State. I'm kind of surprised that Iowa State played very well against us. I'm kind of surprised that Oklahoma State's out in front like that. But evidently, they've got a better football team than they showed when we played them down in Silver.
That brings it all the way back to the 33-yard line, that penalty does, and so Nebraska is be facing, let's just call it for all intents and purposes, a first down and 20. That'll make it officially first and 18.
Nebraska has a split end on the left and a flanker out there, split end the right, flanker to left, and Maurer's back to throw. He throws a pass complete to Craig, but there's no gain on the play.
Roger Craig would have been lucky even to get back to the original line of scrimmage. No, he lost 2 yards, so
right.
They'll go back now and now make it second down and 20 yards.
Oklahoma diagnosed that play very well, and now Nebraska is in a long yardage situation here. I would say they'll probably try to get this in two chunks. They can get some this down and try to get some the next down, and so I don't think you'll find them really going for broke on this play.
Anthony Steele's wide to the top of the screen. Todd Brown to the bottom. Maurer just straight drop back pass. Looking long. Throws deep. He's looking for Todd Brown. And Brown can't get it, but there are flags all over the place.
Right.
Let's see what we've got.
I think that Brown could have been interfered with because it looked like it was supposed to be an out pattern where he started out and then turned up. And it looked like he was interfered with over there on the sideline. So we'll take a look.
We may not get it. I think the flags are down. You see the flag down already.
Yes, it's an interference call, and they did go deep, but there was an out-and-up pattern.
So Nebraska's going to get the ball at their own 46, 47-yard line, and that will be a first down.
And this was a crucial play. Oklahoma had Nebraska in tough situation there. That'd been an incomplete pass, it'd been third in long yardage. But now they have a first down. The momentum again is going in Nebraska's direction.
Well, as you say, this is the spot on the field where Nebraska can put its entire offensive playbook into motion. And they've got a minute 54 to play with here in the first half, leading by 10, 17-7. Irving Fryer in motion.
Here's that reverse play again. They're going to throw off of it.
Irving Fryer passes to Todd Brown. It's just out of his reach. What a nice pass by Irving Fryer, and he is just a little bit upset that he threw it. I tell you what, too, it looked like Todd Brown slowed up just a second there. Not sure he was going to get the pass. Let's watch and see what happens.
We're going to see the replay on it. It's a pitch out to Craig. He hands the ball to Fryer. Fryer starts to the left and then stops and throws. He looks like he's thrown the football before. Has a good job, but it's just out of the reach of Brown.
Just fingertips. Brown was kind of held up there, too, for a moment, which was okay because the pass wasn't in the air, and I think that's probably what kept Brown from getting to it. Up the middle, Roger Craig inside Oklahoma territory at the 49-yard line.
If we can get... we can get a couple of more first downs here before the time runs out. We could get in field goal range. I think we have to be down around the 30 to 25 to 30 yard line before we get in field goal range. But I'm sure Tom is trying to get down there to put another score on the board. And I'm just as sure as Barry Switzer is playing real tough to not let this happen.
Maurer rolling left, throwing, complete, first down, Irving Fryer. And the clock will continue to run. He did not get out of bounds. The ball is at the 41-yard line of Oklahoma. 1:07 to go, but they will stop it to move the chains. And so Nebraska will have a chance to organize.
Again, I can emphasize again the fine job that Mark Maurer is doing at quarterback. He rolled out to his left there. He threw an excellent pass out there. He got enough for the first down, and the drive is still moving.
Eddie Neal getting warmed up on the sidelines. His services may indeed be called on. Maurer back to pass. Good block by Phil Bates. Pass protection. Pass is out there. And I'll tell you what, had that not been tipped by Todd Brown, it probably would have been intercepted. So Todd Brown couldn't get it, and he knocked it away. A fine play by him because Dwight Drain was right there to intercept it.
And Maurer has been on target most of the time today. His pass been thrown well, and he has real fine pass protection.
Here you see. Good pass protection there. Rick Bryan trying to get in, just can't get in even close.
Looks like Remington's coming off the field here. It looked like number 50 there. Maurer.
intercepted. That's Gary Lowell. And he's brought down. He fumbles the ball, and Nebraska gets it back. Roger Craig on the fumble recovery. Gary Lowell made the interception, and then he couldn't hold on to it.
This was quite a drastic turn of events. It looked like Oklahoma had the ball. The interception man did a great job of running with the football, and then all of a sudden he forgot that he was supposed to hang on to it. Here you see him with the football here.
Tacky Schick tipped it up in
number
the air.
25. He did a real good job of running, but it'd been better if he'd got on the ground there. But there goes the football, and Craig has it. Nebraska has another shot.
So Nebraska has the ball at the 35-yard line. First down.
There's 38 seconds left to get on the board. We can do it. Nebraska can do this.
Here we see it again. And Roger Craig, Roger on the spot at this particular time. 17-7, Nebraska. 38 seconds.
And the Oklahoma defense is really put to test here right now. They've got to prevent this score. I think they feel they've got to prevent it to stay in the game. They look a little disorganized that time even.
Mark Muller out at the 5, 10, to make it the 15-yard line.
Time is out.
Mike Rozier.
And you know, on that play, there were some Oklahoma defensive men running around out there in the formation. They didn't appear to really understand what was going on, or they'd been substituted late. And there was a disorganization there in the Oklahoma defensive secondary and linebacker.
So Nebraska with the ball at the Oklahoma 15-yard line. First down, Todd Brown wide to the left. Rozier also receiving out to the left. Anthony Steeles goes in motion. Power looking over the middle. It is caught by Craig. Out of 5 down to the 1-yard line.
A crossing pattern to the tight end, Mitch Crank. He's wide open.
And Nebraska calls timeout. So the Huskers are down at the 1-yard line. They call timeout. Mark Maurer come over to talk it over. 24 seconds to go first half. It's 17-7 Nebraska. 4 seconds to go here in the first half. The Huskers are huddled around the 10-yard line because they've got the ball on the Oklahoma 1-yard line. They already lead 17-7, and they are trying to make it a 24-7 ball game here in this first half. Mark Maurer rejoins his troops to call the play. 24 seconds. Nebraska still's got timeout, so they can call timeout after this if they don't make it. I would have to say that they might go with Phil Bates right up the middle. Touchdown, Nebraska, Roger Craig.
And there was no doubt about it. The center of the Nebraska line just kicked out there. Roger went right up over the top, and he went into the end zone with 3 yards to spare.
I think there may have been a flag on the play. I think that Phil Bates was in motion. I thought Phil left early, but I never saw a flag. Phil's passed Mark Maurer before Maurer even gets the ball.
Yeah, there's a motion call on this play. It took a touchdown away here. And we still have 22 seconds, so, and first down and one timeout.
Well, you know, it seemed like about four people were off before the ball came off, and I think there's a possibility that maybe Remington himself just snapped it a snap late.
Well, Dave usually is snapping it a little quick, according to what the rest of the linemen say, but he might have been a little slow that time and caught him offside.
Because there was about three people that were in motion, a couple of linemen, both guards, and it looked like, of course, obviously, Bates was in motion. So now it brings the ball back to the 5-yard line with 22 seconds to go in the first half. Nebraska still got a first down. So I'm sure that they will probably try to pass it three times and see what happens. Maurer. Over the middle, touchdown!
No Mitch flag.
Craig. And no flag this time. The Huskers have scored to take a 23-7 lead over the Sooners.
And a real well-executed play. It was a diagonal pass to the tight end right across the middle. A crank was open, and Maurer hit him as he crossed there. Fine catch. And this Mitch Crank has been playing fine football for Nebraska since he replaced Jamie Williams. I don't think he's dropped a football.
What a job he's done. Of course, Jamie Williams was injured in that Oklahoma State game, and Frank had to come in and play immediately. The kick by Seibel is indeed good. And so the Nebraska Cornhuskers have taken a 24-7 lead over the Oklahoma Sooners. Frank has now caught three passes for 34 yards. 21-7. I can't be right either. They've got 21-7 up there on the scoreboard, and it should be 24. There they
go. Yes, it's 24-7.
You know, I doubted myself, and the Husker fans are down there. They were wondering what was going on.
Well, I thought maybe that down here in Norman, after a while, they just counted the touchdowns a little less.
I couldn't believe it. I looked at the scoreboard, and I said, wait a minute, that's supposed to read 24-7, and it doesn't.
Well, it's got to be a demoralized Oklahoma football team now that's receiving that kickoff. They've got 18 seconds to go, and really they've got a long, long ways to go. I think they're going into the locker room here, and it's going to be a big job for Barry Switzer and his staff to get this team back up here, ready to come out and play the kind of a game that they want the second half. But Oklahoma is capable of doing this, so we certainly cannot sell them out in this ballgame.
And I'll tell you what, though, the Nebraska Cornhuskers certainly play their best football in the third and fourth periods. In the third period, for instance, Nebraska's outscored their opponents 101-16. So if the entire season statistics hold true, it wouldn't hold out much hope for Oklahoma to really make a tremendous showing, because Nebraska does play well in that third quarter. A squib kick is going to go out of bounds by Seibel. He was just trying to prevent, I think, the long run back.
Right. He'll probably kick another end-over-end kick, kind of a knuckleball like that, to try to prevent the long run back, because Oklahoma here is only going to, they probably can get one play after the kickoff, and that's about it.
18 seconds to go in the first half, and our score, Nebraska 24, the Oklahoma Sooners 7, and there is a bunch of quiet people at Owen Field. All week long when I was down here, Bob, there was an attitude here that just totally doubted.
He going home?
Bob was just pointing out they got a lot of people walking on the sidelines down there. I think a lot of people may either be going home or going out to get something to eat at halftime. I think they're probably going over to get something to eat at halftime, but Bob was saying they're going home here in the first half already. I don't think they're leaving that early, Bob.
I'll say this, Wayne, that would be very unusual for them.
It's a high short kick. Buster Rhymes
calls a fair catch.
So Buster calls a fair catch on a kickoff at the 17-yard line, and that's where the Sooners will start with 18 seconds to go.
Well, if Oklahoma is going to try a desperation pass, here's where they'll start it. I don't know what to think. I kind of think Barry may be thinking it wise to go in the locker room without any further score in against him. So I doubt if they'll do anything real spectacular, but they are going to throw it.
Shepard has plenty of time to throw it. Buster Rhymes is open. Sammy Sims almost intercepted it.
If the two Nebraska players hadn't come together, Sims come together there, was hit by another player there.
Rodney Lewis.
Rodney Lewis hit Sims. Either one of them probably could have intercepted the ball. And this could have, with all the space they had, they might have returned that ball down to where we might at least got a shot at a field goal.
You know, I'll tell you another thing.
Right there.
I'll tell you another thing that's kind of interesting about it. That was only the second pass, of course, that Shepard has thrown today. But another thing interesting, Rhymes was just kind of waltzing around out there. He really didn't know. He was like at the end of his pattern and didn't really know where to go.
Oklahoma's very disorganized right now. You see them running around here. They don't probably throw that ball enough to be sure where to line up sometimes.
Darrell Shepard over the middle. Had a man wide open, but it was Bobby Grayson, but a fine defensive play there by Nebraska. The crowd here doesn't like it. Bobby Grayson, he's the leading pass receiver for this club with 9 catches, 183 yards, averaging 20 yards per catch. He feels like he was interfered with. There's Mike Rozier. Does he look ever happy?
Well, I'll say this. Barry is going all out. I thought he might go in here without firing this ball up in the air like this, something they don't do too well, but he's thrown it twice. He's thrown it a long ways, and I think he probably will do the same thing this time, or at least he's got nothing to lose by throwing it deep this time because there's only 3 seconds left on the clock.
This will be the last play of the first half. It looks like the Cornhuskers will go in with a 24-7 lead if they can get Stanley Wilson corralled. Indeed, they do. And so we come to the end of the first half and listen to the Husker fans across the way. Halftime here at Norman. The score, Nebraska 24, Oklahoma 7. We'll be back in a minute. Well, we are back here in Norman, Oklahoma. Wayne DeZubak with Bob Devaney here at halftime as the Nebraska band gets ready to perform here. But Bob, this is kind of an interesting game. I don't think a lot of people expected it to be 24-7 in favor of Nebraska here at the halftime.
You know, especially after the start that Oklahoma got. I was mentioned to you earlier, this reminded me some of 1969. We came down to play the University of Oklahoma. They scored on us in the first minute and a half of the ball game. We were down 7-0. Then Nebraska came back that year, and I think the score was almost identical of what it is at this time with a young man named Van Bronson, who was sort of a, you might say, second-string quarterback coming up and playing a great ball game. Mark Maurer is doing the same thing today.
You know, everybody is playing a great ball game. You have to look, though, to Mark Maurer, a man who, because really after the last game against Iowa State, Turner Gill was expected to play in this game. It wasn't until Sunday night that things went bad for Turner Gill, and Monday morning it was found out that Mark Maurer would start. He's done a great job of preparing himself.
He certainly has. He's had excellent poise. He's thrown the ball almost perfectly. He's got great protection, and he just performed very well. In fact, the whole Nebraska team, after that slow start by the defense, had played excellent football.
Let's talk about the fact, what is Nebraska going to have to do now defensively to stop Stanley Wilson? He seems to be the one that is having the great success. And with this defensive effort in mind, what about that offense for Oklahoma? Because obviously, they're going to probably have to change their entire game plan now.
They've got to try to score quickly. They may keep hammering away, thinking they're going to go with what is the best of their offense. That's Wilson and Shepard. But I think, Wayne, that they've got to come up with some throwing in this game, and they're going to do a few things they don't really want to do. I think they'll start out trying to see what they can do with their regular offense. And then if they can't generate enough offense to get themselves back in the ball game, then I think they're going to have to do something that they don't want to do, and that's throw the football.
So the Nebraska Cornhusker marching band here, and they are enjoying themselves at halftime with the Cornhuskers leading the Oklahoma Sooners 24-7. And of course, Nebraska wants to wrap this game up because they want to go to the Big Eight and the Orange Bowl after beating Oklahoma. They have gone 6-0, and they say their season will not be complete unless they beat Oklahoma. With me right now is Jim Barker. He is from the Orange Bowl committee, and I think you have to be pleased with, since the fact the Huskers are coming, that the Huskers right now are leading this game.
Yes, it's a little bit more peaceful now. Of course, the way they started, and Oklahoma moved down the field, and with that great wishbone offense, it had us a little bit nervous, but Nebraska's a great football team. They showed a lot of character and poise, and they've come back to take control of the game so far.
I think the reason that it's important that Nebraska win today as far as the Orange Bowl is concerned is because you do have your eyes on Clemson, and no bids have been awarded yet because that's today later on this afternoon. But should Clemson complete the regular season undefeated, then you have to look to the Penn State-Pittsburgh game as a possibility of an upset there. Maybe Clemson could come into the Orange Bowl number one.
That's exactly right, and of course there are a lot of ifs, and we've had a lot of if meetings in the last few weeks, Wayne, but that's the way we see it, and we have representatives in Clemson this afternoon for the game. I understand it's 15-13 Clemson so far.
So there's another game that kind of keeps you on your feet. This has got to be tough anymore. It seems like it's become so competitive between the bowls.
Yes, it has, and we've been traveling on the road since the Labor Day weekend watching the games, and we meet every Monday morning at 7:30 and analyze all the previous results and go through the best games that we want to see. Of course, my job is I'm a Big 8 person. I'm the team entertainment chairman this year for the Big 8 committee, and I've made 4 trips out here, and we'll make another one to the Big 8. So the Midwest is comfortable for me, and I feel right at home here.
You've seen your fair share of Nebraska games this year. Maybe you've seen them more than I have. What do you think of the Huskers?
I think Nebraska's got an outstanding, strong football team. This is the third time I've seen them. I truly think if they played Penn State today, they would beat them. I saw them play that game, and they were beaten 28-24, but I think they should have won it.
Jim Barker with the Orange Bowl committee, and good enough, we'll be seeing you on New Year's night down there.
Thank you, Wayne. It's a pleasure to be here.
Back on the field, the Nebraska Cornhuskers continue to march, and we are going to go back to Omaha now for the latest in the news, both locally and regionally, with Carol Schrader and Ted Mullen. So let's go back to Omaha. It is halftime here in Norman, Oklahoma, with the Nebraska Cornhuskers leading the Oklahoma Sooners by a score of 24-7. And we talked about it being a surprise, and I certainly believe that it is indeed a surprise. Bob, you've been here before. What is, I guess there's been a mystique about Oklahoma, or is that a correct word in years past? And I think this 24-7 score right now has really kind of busted that wide open.
Well, you know, Wayne, Oklahoma, in the games we have played them over the years, it seems like that in the crucial times, they don't make the mistake. Somebody else does. Now, today, this has changed around. Oklahoma has made the mistakes. Nebraska has played almost error-free football. They've executed well offensively and defensively, except for the one drive. If it hadn't been a fine Nebraska team and a well-coached team, a well-disciplined team, they could have defolded after that first easy touchdown that Oklahoma scored. But they came right back and scored, and now it appears like they've taken command of the game, at least at the present time. Coach Tom Osborne this week, he and his staff and the players have been more loose, more relaxed. They seem to come down here with a lot of confidence that perhaps we haven't had for many years. They've done a great job in preparing this team for this ball game, and they're just playing a real excellent football game. Now, of course, we've got another half to go. The game is not over yet. But at this point, I'll say that it's just been a great first half for the Cornhuskers.
And I'll tell you one thing before you write off the fact that the Oklahoma Sooners are just in the down year. Before this season began, Barry Switzer and company, and they should know their people, they felt that they had one of the fine football teams again this year.
Right. Barry was very confident. And then when the Skyriders made their tour, why, they picked unanimously, they picked Oklahoma as the first place team. And this was what it was expected to be. Yet Oklahoma has some problems this year. Nebraska came off some adversity. In the first four games, they lost two of the first four games. People kind of wrote them off. But they just kept coming back and getting better each week. Right now, I think they may be as good as any football team in the nation.
Well, I'll tell you what, we've got a couple of minutes before we kick it off again here from Norman, Oklahoma. So let's take a timeout, and we'll be back for the second half kickoff with a score. The Cornhuskers 24 and the Oklahoma Sooners 7.
This 7TV Sports exclusive is brought to you by Northwestern Bell, Zenith, True Value Hardware, the Ralston Bank, Nebraska Furniture Mart, and Runza.
We are back in Norman, Oklahoma. Wayne DeZubak along with Bob Devaney, and we'd like to take this opportunity to welcome all those folks who are watching today, and to those folks in the Kearney area who will be watching the game on a delay basis. We are happy to have everybody here with us today for this game, 24-7, Nebraska leading. As far as the statistics are concerned, right now, Bob, we just got some statistics here. We see that Nebraska right now, 143 yards rushing. Oklahoma, 212 yards rushing. Total offense, though, 255 for the Huskers, 23 for Oklahoma.
Well, Wayne, the interesting statistic is our passing, 112 yards the first half. Mm-hmm. We have great passing balance between passing and running. And I think that passing has been the difference, really, in the ballgame.
The Nebraska Cornhuskers looking good here in this game today with that 24-7 lead. Roger Craig, what an afternoon he's had. He's carried the ball 10 times for 63 yards. Mike Rozier, 9 carries for 41 yards. But the running game so far has been stolen by Stanley Wilson, a great individual effort, with 104 yards and 13 attempts. So Stanley Wilson is really doing a job. It just seems like the rest of the team having some problems.
All right, Stanley Wilson, we felt that we had to stop Wilson, and I think Nebraska knew that that Wilson was going to gain yardage. But except for the first drive, they have contained him, and they have contained Shepard, the two real threats. And I think this half we're going to concentrate on the same thing, but I think Oklahoma's going to have to try to do something just a little different there.
Remember when we talked to Jim Barker, he was talking about that Clemson game. Well, Clemson now has a little bit of bigger lead, and they are leading 22-13 over South Carolina at this point in the third period. And, of course, we're interested in Clemson because if they can continue to go through their season undefeated, and they do come up with an Orange Bowl bid, which could be extended later this afternoon, and Nebraska wins this game, could be a matchup of two top five teams. Clemson could be number one. Let's say down the road that Penn State upsets Pittsburgh a week from today. And if that does indeed happen, then we could have Clemson number one in the Orange Bowl, Nebraska maybe third or fourth. And even though Nebraska would have two losses, not a bad outside chance at a national championship, at least finishing in the top two.
Right. It'd be a great finish. And now Nebraska has the ball. We received the kickoff this time at our choice. And we have Mark Maurer leading Nebraska out on the 20-yard line.
It's Phil Bates at fullback. And he takes it up the middle. Five-yard gain for Phil out to the 25-yard line. Rozier was in there at eye back for the Huskers. So Tom Osborne, you see on the sidelines, has to be happy. You can't tell it by looking at him right now, but he's got to be somewhat pleased that he's got the 24-7 lead at this particular point.
Well, Wayne, you know, I think Oklahoma has got a feeling, I know their coaching staff, if I analyze it correctly, have a feeling that if they don't score first in this second half, that they're in trouble.
A little bit of confusion. They wanted to get Rozier over here on the right side. He had taken off to the left side out of the huddle. And
there's Rozier reverse, it. Well-executed reverse, but the Oklahoma defense comes up with a good defensive effort.
Well, Irving Fryer that time had a nice block on Elbert Watts, number 17, and I think Rozier might have wanted to take the outside route on him because, if anything else, now there's Rick Bryan. He's going off the field limping. He is one of the key defensive standouts for this Oklahoma team. Let's see what happened to him. He gets knocked right down by Remington.
And this, that reverse play, while it didn't break all the way as it looked like it might, it did get us a first down.
First down, Nebraska, out at the 32-yard line. Pitch out. Rozier. Rozier is going to be caught behind the line of scrimmage, dropped at the 29-yard line. Benson in there.
Yeah, this was a good defensive play. There's a linebacker plugged on that play, and he got into our backfield before Rozier could turn the corner.
Barry Switzer is not happy at all. He was quoted earlier this week as saying that they wanted to send the Huskers out in the same old style, a loss to Oklahoma. And I don't think that said well with a lot of Nebraska fans who were here already in Oklahoma City. In motion, Fryer.
Here's that pitch.
Well, Rozier trying to cut back in. Looked like he lost his balance just a little bit. Gets it out to the 33-yard line. It'll be third down and eight.
This is a play that Nebraska has used quite effectively. They put the wing back in motion to the left and then the pitch out to the eye back. But this time, as Rozier cut upfield, he did slip, or he might have made some yardage.
Keith Stanbury, number 19 for Oklahoma, was the man who forced the play inside. Did his job well. Sooner crowd comes to life here, sensing the fact that Nebraska is in deep trouble trying to get this first down with the third and 11.
And here Maurer back to throw.
Over the middle, could be pass interference, but they're not going to call it.
No, it was, the pass was almost complete. It was real close down there. I believe it was intended for Steels, but the receiver down there, I believe it was Anthony Steels the pass was intended for. We can see here in a minute. Maurer is rushed just a little more this time, but he does have good protection. And yes, I think that Steele's come across, and it looked like it could have been interference, but the ball and the receiver got there about the, or the defensive man got about the same time.
It was very close. I'll tell you, when you're this high up in the press box, sometimes those look a little different. Yeah. See the replay.
Oklahoma put a pass, a punt rush on there, and it's not a good punt. It's a short punt.
Watts makes a fair catch. The ball's out the 45-yard line. So Oklahoma with good field position at the Nebraska at their own 45-yard line. Grant Campbell comes to the sideline after a 25-yard punt.
Grant Campbell has been averaging about 50 yards on his punts the last few ball games. This time he was rushed and he got kind of an end-over-end kick that didn't go far into the wind.
Well, season long, he's at 44 yards per kick. The last few games, he's really been booting him. Shepard keeps it. He's hit by Krejci again up from his defensive back spot. What a game Jeff Krejci has been playing.
And Nebraska seems to have diagnosed that option play, at least at the present time. They've strung it out. They've had a man on the fullback. They've had a man on the quarterback. Krejci's come up, hit the quarterback. And they've had a defensive cornerback coming up to play that pitch.
No game, second and 10.
And the end has been stringing the play out here. Nebraska's playing an even front here. This is something they don't do too long, but they're playing an even front against this defense.
Shepard's going to pass. Had Clewis out there, but he threw it too far.
Right, they had this pass could have been incomplete for a first down, but Shepard just overthrew his receiver. Oklahoma is not a good passing team. Shepard is limping now. I don't know how long he's going to last this half. He might go through the whole half, but he is limping, and he's not running quite as effectively as he was, and he certainly has not been effective throwing the ball.
No, he hasn't. He's completed only one of four attempts for only 11 yards.
And once more, Oklahoma's into a passing situation. They got a wing formation here.
He's passing again. Shepard over the middle. Complete.
And the receiver is open. He's wide open.
Yeah, and that was Cluis. And that's good for a first down into Nebraska territory at the 39-yard line. We look at it again, and we see that Shepard just kind of rolled it out to the right, and Cluis came back in from the outside. And he was wide open.
Right, he's in a hook zone. It's about a 14-yard hook pattern, just enough for the first down. Oklahoma's in a wing again to the left, and now they come back with motion.
Sammy Wilson, 8-yard gain.
Well, I'll say this, Wayne. The Oklahoma team thus far has not looked like a team that felt they were beaten.
Well, the first time they had the ball in the first half, they just took it right down the field in sixth place and punched it in 80 yards. And they're moving the ball well here in the second half.
They're down now. They have a second down and about 1.5 on the 31-yard line of Nebraska.
Shepard, he's caught.
He's stopped.
Not going to get the first down.
There's a very short game, if any, on the play, and they sent their fullback in motion. Now, that play has not been effective. They sent the fullback in motion away from the direction of the play, but it hasn't seemed to fool anybody, and Shepard is out there without the fullback to fake to, and it makes that option play less effective.
They have to get to the 29-yard line in Nebraska for a first down, third down, and about half a yard. Up the middle, he's got the first down. That's Buster Rhymes.
That's the power play. This Oklahoma team has used that power play on short yardage there continually. They have with the two backs ahead of the halfback, the fullback, and the left halfback in front of the right halfback has been an effective short yardage play.
Little sideline fun here in Norman, Oklahoma. So, the Sooners moving the football. They got it on their own 45-yard line, and they've been moving it. Up the middle, Stanley Wilson, 10. He's down at the 8-yard line. So, once again, Stanley Wilson, the kind of guy he just can't seem to stop today.
I'll say this. Stanley Wilson is a football player that has got a lot of heart. He kept on going there. He was stopped just past the line of scrimmage. He kept on going, and he looked like he almost was going in for the touchdown.
Tony Felici grabbed him from behind. It was Brett Evans who made the hit on him right there, almost at the line of scrimmage. But it's first and goal to go for the Oklahoma Sooners, who trail 24-7 with 10 minutes to go in the third period. This is what they wanted to do, is to come out and score. Shepard is hit hard, fumbles it out of bounds, and they will lose 5 yards on the play, but they have the ball.
All right, this is the kind of thing that has hurt the Oklahoma offense, that fumble in crucial times against Missouri. They had several chances last week to score when they were down in the game, and they fumbled the football. And right now, if we can stop them here, if we can stop Oklahoma from scoring a touchdown here, and Oklahoma is taking a timeout. There's a little indecision here, or else somebody's hurt.
Okay, 9:48 to go in the third period. Oklahoma timeout. The score, Nebraska 24, the Sooners 7. Second down and goal from the 12-yard line. The Sooners trying to push it across. They lost 4 yards to that play. The fumble by Shepard out of bounds.
It was a big defensive play for the Cornhuskers. They had the option play played real well. Shepard was hit, and he fumbled after he was hit.
They've got to take it in. Shepard back to pass, looking, a screen pass off to Stanley Wilson, and Wilson is hit. He's down to the one. And every way they can, they use Stanley Wilson.
It was a well-executed play, and it was a good call from the bench. Evident that Oklahoma needed big yardage, and they had to get a big chunk in that one play. But it looks like Wilson might be down on the ground, and this would be quite a blow to Oklahoma's hopes if Wilson is not able to continue in this ball game. In fact, it could have a bearing on whether they could get into the end zone or not this time.
I'll tell you what, Wilson now has carried the ball 15 times and he's gained 133 yards, but he has 155 yards in total offense when he catches the ball as well, so he would be a tremendous loss for the Oklahoma Sooners at this particular point. We'll take a look and see if we can see exactly what happened. I'm not so sure exactly what the injury was. At first, when I saw the first replay about it, I thought maybe it was an ankle somebody held on. But now they don't look like they're attending to his ankle.
No, it looks like he might have the wind knocked out of him or a rib injury or something like that, because they're not doing anything with his legs there. I believe he had, if anything, got the wind knocked out of him. He's probably awfully tired. He's getting to his feet here. But it don't look like he's coming into the ball game right now. This is a blow to Oklahoma because they don't have another back that's a threat. They've only got a yard to go, but that could be a tough yard without Stanley Wilson.
Well, Stanley Wilson's on the bench right now. The Sooners have a third and goal to go from the one-yard line. Handoff. Shepard outside, he's in for the touchdown, Darrell Shepard. And the Oklahoma Sooners are starting to come back. It's 24-13.
This was a crucial play. Darrell Shepard kept the football that time, and Nebraska had been defensing the option play with a quarterback keeping very well. But down close to the goal line there, they didn't have anybody on him. Didn't seem like anybody was playing Shepard, and he went into the end zone almost untouched. He went over the top of a tackler.
Mike Keeling puts it through the uprights, and so with 9 minutes and 28 seconds to go in the third quarter, our score, Nebraska 24, Oklahoma 14. Anthony Steeles and Irving Fryer deep for the Nebraska Cornhuskers to receive the kickoff of Mike Keeling. Just a little note that ABC and 7TV will be televising the Notre Dame-Miami of Florida game this Friday. That's the day after Thanksgiving. It all begins at 2 o'clock here on 7TV. Notre Dame-Miami of Florida.
You know, Wayne, Oklahoma did just the thing that we said they had to do to keep themselves in the ball game. They got possession of the football and they scored before we did. And now it's a ball game. We've got to play good football. It's an entirely different situation.
Steeles, he dropped it, but he gets it out to the 13-yard line. Anthony Steeles bobbled the ball right there at the goal line, took a bounce, and he was able to get it back, but it cost him a few yards, I'm sure. Now the Oklahoma crowd will get behind their Sooner defense. The crowd may become a factor. Here you see Steeles takes a bounce. Good bounce for him, but by this point, he lost some of his blockers, and he was in trouble. Gary Lowell down there.
Nebraska now deep in their territory, first down on their own 12-yard line with an inspired Oklahoma team on defense.
Roger Craig in there at I back. Phil Bates, the fullback. Mark Maurer is the quarterback. Roger Craig to the 20. Up to the 21. I think he's just shy of the first down.
A real fine job of the right side of the Nebraska line. He opened up a fine hole. Craig held on to that football. And it looks like we got a chance to move that ball up and get the ball out of that deep territory by our own goal line.
Second down and one. Nebraska has to get to the 22, actually just beyond the 22-yard line for a first down. Up the middle.
Oh, there's
Bates.
Real fine hole.
First down and more, much more, up to the 39-yard line. And Nebraska, in two plays, has gone from terrible field position to great field position. Look at this play right up the middle, Bob.
This is a great play. There's a fine job, a great big hole, and Bates just shakes off tacklers and drives over some others. This is a great job of running by Phil Bates, who is a real excellent fullback. And as I mentioned earlier, somewhat underrated fullback. Fine runner.
We are seeing the number one and number two rushing teams in the country put on quite a show here today. Gain of a couple that time. Bates
on the first down there probably got 2 or 3 yards. It wasn't wasn't as spectacular. Dave Remington shows him getting off the football here. Good job of blocking Johnny Lewis. He moved Johnny Lewis straight back, number 95.
Bates now 6 for 53 yards. He's carried 6 times, so everybody seems to be piling up a little bit of yardage today. Nebraska, the pitch out. Roger Craig opening 50 and down to the 44-yard line.
Mauer was hit awfully hard on that play. Mauer was really hit on that play, shaken up, but he's getting up and he seems to be all right, but he was really nailed after he pitched out that ball.
Just shy of the 46, but it's good for a first down, so Nebraska on the move again. And this is a key drive for the Cornhuskers. They really needed to keep the ball for a little while, run some time off the clock. I tell you, the way Oklahoma's been running their wishbone, even though they're down 24-14, the best way to keep them from scoring is to keep them from having the football.
Right. That's the best way to defense a ball control team like Oklahoma.
Mauer, Roger Craig, and he is going to get inside the 45, down to the 43, gain of about 3.
Well, we're getting down close to that 4-down territory where you've got 4 downs to make that first down instead of 3. And I think this time, if we get down there around the 30, 35, or I would say the 40 or their 38-yard line, I think we may go for it if we have to on 4th down. But I hope we don't have to do it. 3rd down now and 7.
Craig and Iback, he still has 86 yards rushing so far this afternoon. Up the middle, Bates, he goes outside, and he is stopped. It'll bring up a 3rd down play, and they say he may have been a fumble on the play. Let's see what they call.
I think they ruled it our ball. They ruled Bates was down, and it looks like he still has the ball, but...
Now, a couple Sooners came out of there, Rick Bryan, claiming that they had the football, but Bates had it all the time.
And Oklahoma has a man down in the field. They've had injury problems this year, and
it could be Johnny Lewis, number 95. It's hard to see right from here.
The situation right now, they have had to take 3 or 4 players off the field.
Well, they helped Johnny Lewis off. We've got the clock stopped at 6:48 to go in the third period, with Nebraska leading 24-14 as they take Johnny Lewis off the field. And of course, he looks like he is all right. He's off there under his own power. Nebraska will be faced with a 3rd down and 6. Sun starting to set in the west. The shadows of the press box starting to come over the field. The shadows getting long here in Norman, Oklahoma. Mauer looking to pass. Has the time over the middle. Quick! Todd Brown, complete first down. What a hit Todd took.
There's a great play. A great play by Todd Brown. A fine pass by Mark Mauer. This is another example of that crucial play at the right time. A great execution, and we needed that. That was a big, big play in this ball game.
That's Todd Brown's first reception, and what a catch. He got hit. Boom! And he just holds on to the football. What a tough young man that is.
Todd Brown is a fine pass receiver. He's done a great job catching this football in his career at the University of Nebraska. He's done a great job.
So the Huskers with the ball at the 24-yard of Oklahoma, hoping to punch it in here and get something up on the scoreboard to negate that touchdown of Oklahoma. Roger Craig, Jackie Schiff finally throws him down. Benson in there as well. Craig maybe a couple of yards at the very most.
Tackle by Benson and Schiff. Right lane also on the play.
Todd Brown really got popped right in the head there. We saw a moment ago. Oklahoma cheerleading squad. Second down. Let's call it 8. Power hands off to Roger Craig. Roger goes outside, cuts back in, down close to a 1st down. Needed to get to the 15. He's just shy.
Just short of 15, but it puts us now again in a short yardage situation. We're in 4-down territory. We have 2 downs to make that 1 yard.
Watch Roger Craig. Nothing up the middle. Changes direction, goes outside. Nice run by Craig.
This is one of Roger's very finest football games. He's played excellent football. He's ran hard. He's held on to that football. And he's scrambled for that extra yard.
95 yards rushing for Craig on the day. 1 yard to go for a 1st down. Up the middle, Craig. He's very close. He is very close. It depends where they're going to mark it. He had to go inside the 15. So we could be facing a fourth down situation.
And it's a question whether Tom will go for the fourth down or take what looks to be an easy field goal opportunity.
Be fourth down.
It will be fourth down.
Well, it looks like they're going for it.
Well, the Huskers will go for it. I said they had to get just inside the 15. The nose of the ball is just there. I think they have to go maybe two more inches.
Right, they got to go about halfway between that 15 and what's the 14-yard line. Look like where that point of that stick is there.
I'm sure that the Huskers, we'll just have to wait and see. I was going to say, I'm sure they'll go up the middle, but we'll wait and see. And there's a penalty. Nebraska had too much time. Osborne was calling for a timeout. He saw that it was about to happen.
Tom now has changed his strategy, and Nebraska's going for that field goal instead of that first down. And, of course, it's the only thing Tom can do in this situation here. He had nearly 6 yards to go in one play, and we do have good position on the field. The ball is right in the middle of the field. It's on the 20-yard line, which makes it about a 32-yard field goal, well within the range of Neal.
The wind has even died down more, so I don't believe that that'll be a factor from this distance. So Eddie Neal, the kick is up, and it is good.
It's good.
So Eddie Neal gets the second field goal of the game, and Nebraska has scored with 3:53 to go in the third period. Nebraska has a 27-14 lead over the Oklahoma Sooners.
And believe me,
you can see they're still working on Todd Brown. It took quite a lick in that drive, but he's up. Mark Maurer talking to him, says he's okay. 3:53 to go here in the third period. Huskers getting a much-needed drive, 67-yard drive, and then the 37-yard field goal by Eddie Neal. So that makes it 27-14 Nebraska. But right now the key is going to be defensively, and I'm sure that they have talked to the Huskers about that. They've got to stop the Sooners.
It's good kick. It goes down about to the 1 yard line. They're going to run it.
Buster Rhymes. He almost breaks. He fumbles, and Nebraska has it. Buster Rhymes fumbles the football, and I believe Nebraska has it. And who was that that recovered it?
Wayne, this is a big point in the ball game here. If we can get this ball in there now, it's a very important thing, and I. From this situation on, I think we're in good position. I don't think that offense is going to let us down here. I think they're going to keep going. Rhymes is carrying that ball like he's got a loaf of bread in his hands. He's got a way out there. There's no wonder he could carry the ball that way.
Nebraska up the middle. We didn't have a chance to see who that was that got it. I'll tell you what, I think it was either 43, that Bates.
Bates carrying the football that time.
Well, I think it was Seibel that got the recovery. That's what we're looking for. Seibel got the recovery. Still trying to figure out who got that one. And, boy, I'll tell you, there's a bunch of white jerseys down there. Now, Nebraska, if they can take this in here, can maybe put this game away. Second down and three for the Huskers inside the 10. Bates at fullback. That's Irving Fryer in motion. The pitch out goes to Rozier. He's got some blocking. There's the corner, and he's out at the 3.
First down.
Mike Rozier out at the 3-yard line. Nebraska threatening again. First and goal to go.
Buster Rhymes has had a terrible time back there returning kickoffs today. He's had a lot of trouble, and in that time, he let loose of that football at a very, very crucial time.
Tom Osborne looking on intently. First and goal to go. The Huskers have 4 plays, I am sure, to move it 3 yards. They try the middle base, touchdown!
There's no question there. Dave Remington, the two guards and tackles, just looked like they wedged in there ahead of Bates, and he just went into that end zone. He was 4 yards in the end zone.
Well, Phil Bates takes it in for the score that makes it 33-14, Nebraska. The Huskers pouring it on, and you have to give the Nebraska offensive unit credit because they took it in after recovering the fumble. They have now scored 10 points in 49 seconds. So the Huskers, using those explosives, last week against Iowa State, they scored 24 points in 5 minutes and 8 seconds. Seibel's kick is good. And the score, with 3 minutes and 4 seconds to go in the third period, Nebraska 34, Oklahoma 14. So after the Buster Rhymes fumble recovered at the 15 by Kevin Seibel, Nebraska took only three plays to hit pay dirt. And with 3:04 to go in the third quarter, the Huskers have a commanding 34-14 lead. Bob, we talked, the best way to keep Oklahoma from scoring is not to give them the football. And as long as Buster Rhymes is going to cough it up, I think Oklahoma's going to have an awful tough time getting back in this game.
Right. Their kickoff returns have averaged terribly. They have only got to the 20-yard line. I don't believe they've got the 20-yard line yet with a kickoff return. And that's a signal for a fair catch, which you can do on the kickoff.
That's the second time. I haven't seen it all year long. Rhymes has done it twice now. He's got to be second-guessing himself about getting hit.
I think Barry probably second-guessing himself right now about having Rhymes back there catching those kickoffs. Because he's having some real problems there. There's a lot of indecision. He's a great runner, but he seems to be indecisive as to what he wants to do. And on that kickoff, he did have a chance to return it.
Oklahoma starting at their own 13-yard line. And want to remind you that as soon as this game is over, we will join in progress the USC-UCLA game. Stanley Wilson. Oh, we can't stop him. He just goes right up the middle.
Stanley Wilson gets 6 yards on that play. Of course, if we can keep Oklahoma advancing that ball at a real slow pace, and we can come back and score 10 points in about 40 seconds, we're in pretty good shape.
This, of course, the Sooner team, you know, they say they've got their problems, but my goodness, this is the leading rushing team in the country. And so they are still a powerful Oklahoma team, maybe not as powerful as teams in the past, I won't say that, but they're certainly a good one. Shepard, indecisiveness, but look at that guy run. Gets close to a first down. It is a first down by a yard out at the 25-yard line.
And that was a great individual effort by Shepard. They had two tacklers out there waiting there, and Shepard just eluded both of them. You can see the play coming up over here. There's like Evans right here coming out there, and he misses Shepard. 59 misses Shepard there, and he gets the first down. Shouldn't have made a yard on the play. Shepard and Wilson are two excellent ball carriers.
I think you can really see the talent of this Oklahoma team. They really do. Shepard looking to pass, gets some rushing, and he is going to be brought down. And that is Jimmy Williams making sure he was down for good.
You know, Jimmy Williams, he's a great defensive end. Williams is one of the fastest, if not the fastest, football players on the team.
But it was Kurt Heinlein who put the pressure on.
Yes, and Williams can run the 40 in about 4.34 or 4.4, which is tremendous speed for a man his size. And he is very, very difficult to get around.
Second down, 10 and a half. Good look at Shepard. Up the middle. Boy, Wilson fell that time and gained 4 yards. He's unbelievable.
Well, Oklahoma is now once more into that situation where most teams would be throwing the football. Now, the last series of downs, Oklahoma come up with two key passes. We'll see what they'll do this time. They have third down and 8.
Yeah, he only gained 3 on that slide, so I was a little optimistic. Hey, you see a good shot here at Norman. There's Barry Switzer. He's going, my goodness, is that really the score? 34-14, the Huskers, and we're here at home. And Norman, what's going on? Third down and 8. Shepard. A lot of white shirts. Forget it.
Real fine defensive play by the linebackers in the left side of the Nebraska defense. This time there were too many people. Shepard, there was no way he was going to get away there. And they chose to keep the ball on the ground. Shepard's getting up very slowly. He's getting up slowly each time. He's limping badly off the field now.
By the way, the UCLA-USC game in the second quarter now. UCLA with a 7-3 lead over the Trojans. We will join that game as soon as this game is completed. Keeling punts the ball. It is early.
There goes fired.
That was fire. Or was that Lyday? We are so high up here that at times the binoculars are indeed a necessity. This is the highest press box, and we're up here on the camera level today.
Alan Lyday has been a young man. I believe he walked on at Nebraska, and he's done just a great job playing defensive halfback for us this year. And did a fine job on that punt return.
12-yard punt return, 39-yard punt by Keeling. That's below his average, so Doug Wilkening in at fullback. Maurer, Rozier, and he just went over the entire line. He goes down inside the 50, down to the 49-yard line. Here you can kind of see what we're looking at, how far away, and that's about how it looks to us. They're just basically specks out there, and you need the binoculars at times to pick out the numbers, especially off of those white jerseys in this bright sunlight. Working on Tony Felici on the sidelines. Well, that's the end of the third period, so we come down to the final 15 minutes of play, and the Cornhuskers with a commanding lead, 34-14 over the Oklahoma Sooners. Scoreboard up here just said well wishes to Don Key. He is a guard who earlier this week had a kidney removed for the University of Oklahoma. Young man who at the beginning of this year had a chance to become the first Sooner ever to start all of the games in his career. He had a kidney problem, had to have it removed. It was a thing that came up overnight just about. And some get well wishes for Don Key, and really we send him our best as well.
Right, and we've got some of our first string on the bench now. There's Bates and Crank. I see all them standing over there on the bench. Nebraska has the ball out here, and Maurer is handing off to Rozier, and Rozier's getting to the outside. He's being chased, but he makes about 8 yards on the play. Gets first down.
Tell you what, Rozier is a quick back. I did not realize he was that quick. I think it was the Oklahoma State game when he ran that kickoff back 93 yards for a touchdown. He was really quick. See the exchange there.
Rozier's got good speed, and he's got great power to stay on his feet. He's got very good balance. He changes direction, and he keeps the ball. Rozier is not a fumbler. He holds on to football.
69 yards now for Mike Rozier, 15 carries. First down for the Huskers at the 42-yard line of Oklahoma. Up the middle, Doug Wilkening. He gets inside the 40, close to the 39-yard line. Jackie Shipp gets up off the bottom of the pile.
Well, you know, if Nebraska can hold on and win this ball game, they're going to make those Orange Bowl people awfully happy. I think that they were a little afraid that Nebraska might have a lot of trouble with Oklahoma and would come down into the Orange Bowl with that blot on their record. So I am sure that they're going to be almost as happy as the Cornhusker fans and team.
Outside, Rozier, and Rozier is close to a first down. I think he's got it near the 30-yard line. Boy, Nebraska is really getting around the outside at Oklahoma right now, and I think there's a lot of empty, believe it or not, for here for a jam-packed capacity crowd. There are a lot of people leaving this game already. I think they've had enough frustration in this season. They're saying, I'm not going to take a fourth quarter of Nebraska beating up on Oklahoma, but that's exactly what's happening.
Right, this is something that seldom happens at Owens Field, that the people leave the game before the end unless they have Oklahoma way ahead and leave to go home early. But this game, they're leaving in desperation and sadness, disgust, or whatever you want to call it.
Rozier, what a runner he is. And he gets out of bounds, but I think they're going to blow the whistle dead. And I think, well, he probably should have got another yard or two more than that, but there you see some of the crowd now starting to file out. A lot of action out there when you figure we still have 13:40 to go. And I don't think anybody in their wildest dreams really thought that that would happen.
And there's another injured player from Oklahoma. That's about the fifth Oklahoma player who has left the field because of injury. And this has got to be telling on that defensive unit, because a great many of them have been from the defensive unit.
Clock running, 13:25 to go in the ball game. Good shot of Mark Maurer. Second down and 5.5 for the Huskers. Ball at the 27-yard line. Roger Craig. He fights his way down. First down.
There's a flag over on the right side of the field there. It's in a situation where I think it possibly could be an offensive penalty. We'll have to wait and see. Yes, it's a signal for offensive holding. And so we'll be set back here.
Well, at this point in the game, it may not be as critical a penalty, but of course, it's one of those situations where I think Husker fans everywhere say it's critical, because I don't think we can ever have too big of a lead on the Sooners, no matter what the score is.
You know, we're back here now that we have, instead of second down and 5 as we had previously, despite the gain of 6 yards, We have now a second down and 11.
Again, the Oklahoma cheerleaders here, and I tell you, they're in good form in as much as the fact that the score is 34-14 at this particular point. Second down, about 10 and a half for the Huskers, just outside the 30. Maurer keeps it himself. First time, one of the few times he's run the ball today. Picks up five. It'll bring third up, third and five.
And again, we're in a situation where we can use the fourth down either to make a first down or to try to kick another field goal here. We're down in that territory. And Mark Maurer is running this football team with tremendous efficiency. He's called his plays well, and I'm certain he's got some help from the bench, but he's done a real fine job.
Fine job of execution, a fine job of mental preparation.
There goes the flag again. Maurer's looking for a receiver, and he throws it complete for touchdown.
In the end zone, touchdown, but there are flags. Remember, to Anthony Steele, there are flags on the play, and it probably will be holding against Nebraska.
It could be holding, or it could be a motion penalty. There was a flag thrown right as soon as the ball was snapped, so it is an offside penalty. It's a five-yard penalty, but right now...
Well, you can't take away the execution of that pass, Bob.
That was a great pass play.
Beautiful throw, beautiful catch.
I'm not saying this maliciously, but right now the better job of stopping Nebraska than Oklahoma. And we come up now again with a third down and 10, but I wouldn't bet that we wouldn't make it.
Third down and 10. Down.
I think the Nebraska team is executing so well, and I think at this stage of the game, Oklahoma, their defense is getting tired. They've been on that field a long while, and they have to be somewhat depressed.
34-14. That's the story. Nebraska on top, 12:29 to go. Maurer trying to come back from that. He's got it to Steele's down to the 11-yard line. First down, and Nebraska has another first down, and folks, no flags whatsoever.
And now the first down on the 11-yard line. Nebraska's going to try to really put this ball game away. It's a real fine job of protection. I don't know that I've ever seen a Nebraska passer who has received better protection than Mark Maurer has today.
First down from the 11-yard line. A couple of yards that time. Phil Bates got a couple of finals here. Pittsburgh has beaten Temple. Pittsburgh, the number one team in the country, 35-0 over Temple. Penn State over Notre Dame, final 24-21. Penn State and Pittsburgh play next week. Could be interesting as far as Nebraska is concerned. Iowa at the half leads Michigan State 16-7. If Iowa wins that game, they go to the Rose Bowl. So that should be interesting to see what happens there. Second down. 6 yards, 7 yards to go for the Huskers for first down. Pitch out, Roger Craig trying to get outside. He's not going to do it. He gets away from one man, and he's knocked out of bounds at the 7-yard line.
He fights his way about to the line of scrimmage, so it'll be second down and 7. And you might see Mark Maurer go to the air again. He's passed very efficiently.
102 yards for Roger Craig. He did get 1 yard on his play, but he's gone over the century mark. 102 yards and 18 carries for that man, Roger Craig, and he has done a tremendous job. As his shirt will tell you, he has had people over him all day long. Mark Maurer, third down play.
Nebraska in a spread formation, putting man in motion, Fryer's in motion.
Fryer can't get it.
Just out of the reach of Fryer, the man in motion to the right, Mark Maurer threw it just out of his reach.
Well, Mark got a lot of pressure that time. He had to unload it a little bit before he wanted to.
And the field goal kicking unit comes on the field now.
Eddie Neal.
And this is something that Nebraska has done very well. They've got down in scoring territory, and they have not come away empty-handed. They've got points on the board, either the touchdown or the field goal. And this is very important to the offensive morale.
It'll be a 24-yard attempt for Eddie Neal from the left half mark. Kick is off, I believe. It's good. No, it went right through there. Yeah. So Eddie Neal hits it from 24 yards out. A perfect day for Neal. 10:36 to go in this game. The score, Nebraska 37, Oklahoma 14. Wayne DeZubak with Bob Devaney, and what a game we have had here for you today. 37-14, Nebraska with 10:36 to go in the ball game. Couple of partial scores now in the third period. Oklahoma State 24, Iowa State nothing. In the third period, Missouri 3, Kansas nothing. And I mentioned that Iowa is leading Michigan State 16-7 at the half, and that if Iowa wins it, they would go to the Rose Bowl. The reason? And that is because Ohio State beat Michigan 14-9. Kevin Seibel kicking it off this time. Buster Ryan still back there. He watches it go in and out of the end zone. So Oklahoma will get the ball on their own 20-yard line, where they will have 10 minutes and 36 seconds to make some kind of a comeback, the miracle of which I don't even think is in the Sooner playbook at this point.
No, and you know, whatever it amounts to, the wind is against Oklahoma. In fact, everything seems to be against him right now. They're the kind of a team that is very difficult to play catch up. They have to throw this ball. They're in a spread out formation now. And here you have a quarterback. You have a different quarterback in there, and he throws the football.
Paul Clewis has it, and of course that was Kelly Phelps who was in there, and he threw that right on the line to Clewis.
That's Kelly Phelps' second play. The first play was disastrous, but the second time around, he did a good job.
Clewis, of course, was the young man who caught that football for the touchdown pass against Missouri. First down, the ball is out of the 38-yard line.
The Nebraska defense is loosened up some now. They're not playing up quite as tight on the line of scrimmage as they were. They're trying to prevent the big play here. And, of course, Stanley Wilson can still gain some ground up the middle, but that runs on the clock, and I don't think Oklahoma's got time enough to keep the ball on the ground and get into the ball game.
Stanley Wilson, he has just had a tremendous game no matter how you look at it. Individually, the standout here for Oklahoma has been Stanley Wilson. 7-yard gain that time, second down and 3. Phelps going to be brought down, and that is Tony Felici. Played off the block of Culver, and he was down on the ground, but he was still able to get him. A fine play by Tony Felici.
Tony was right down under Phelps that time. Phelps had to go right over the top of him, and he wasn't able to do so. Tony was in good position there. And here we have a third down situation, and I think with the success Phelps had throwing the ball just a couple minutes ago or a few seconds ago, I think he'll probably put the ball in the air again.
Third down, 5 yards. Let's see what Phelps does. Again, Phelps was the quarterback at the beginning of the year, so he's pretty good.
Running the option play, and he's not going to get the first down. He's going to have to punt.
You saw the blitz by Sammy Sims, and that really goofed up everything for Oklahoma.
Well, there's no way that Oklahoma can get back into this game unless they do generate a passing attack, and it didn't look at that time like they were going to really press that point.
Mike Keeling, Rick Lindquist back deep to receive the punt. Second quarter score, USC now ahead of UCLA, 12-7. Again, as soon as this game is over, we'll be switching you back there to join that game in progress. Husker fans, I am sure, enjoying this game immensely. The Huskers will finish the year with a 9-2 record, 7-0 in the Big 8, truly the Big 8 champions. And still, I believe, if Clemson can win today, a good chance that Nebraska might indeed be able to still play for a national championship New Year's Day.
There was a flag on the play that time. Oklahoma was in motion. It's a question whether Nebraska will take the ball where it is or else they'll ask them to kick again. We're going to wait and see here. They're questioning the Nebraska captain. A penalty against Oklahoma for illegal procedure.
And I think Nebraska will probably decline it and keep the ball because they are at about the 20-yard line.
Well, let's see what they're going to do. Yes, they picked the flag up. Nebraska's taking the football on the 20-yard line.
Anytime you can get that ball, because you never know what's going to happen. You kick that ball again, you fumble it or something. 37-yard punt that time by Keeling was well below his average of 44.5 yards per kick. So Might as well take it while you can get it. Tom Osborne looks like he's going to pick up his second victory in 10 tries against Barry Switzer, and he does so this year in impressive style.
And Wayne, as I said before, I've never seen Tom more, you might say, loose this week. I wouldn't say overconfident, but he seemed to have confidence in what this football team of his could do, and it certainly was not misplaced. They've done a tremendous job. They're well prepared for this game. They're really well prepared to play it, and they've done an outstanding job, both offensively and defensively.
And they're just ripping up yards against Oklahoma. Bates, 9 yards on that carry. Fine player, Phil Bates. Fine individual. Fine gentleman. Second down and one. The ball at the 30. They need to get to the 31-yard line. 8:05 to go. That clock just keeps ticking down. Rozier, he looked like he was stopped. Look at him go down to the 40.
Rozier turned a 1 yard loss into a 10 yard gain. He just bounced off the tackler. He was hit right head on. He just bounced, dropped back a couple steps, and then started forward and made a first down.
93 yards rushing for Mike Rozier. And look at this.
Do we have? Over the other.
First down for Nebraska out at the 41-yard line. 37-14 Nebraska. The pitch out.
It's a reverse option play there. It's well executed, but again, we ran out of room a little bit there, but there was a gain of about 4 yards on the play.
Tell you once again, we'd like to thank everybody who's watching today and to, of course, thanks to those folks in Kearney who will be watching this game on a delay basis. Thanks for joining us here for Nebraska football. It has been an enjoyable afternoon in Norman, Oklahoma. 7 minutes to go now. 37-14, the Huskers with second down and 7. Fryer in motion. Pitch out, Rozier. Rozier cutting back inside. He's belted back, but he got inside, outside the 45 to the 47-yard line to be about 3 yards short. Barry Switzer on the far sidelines in the sun.
It'll be third down now coming up, and probably a passing situation, but there's a timeout on the play. The referee takes timeout. There's an injured Oklahoma player.
Well, we've got timeout on the field. 6:41 to go in the game. The score, obviously, Nebraska 37, the Sooners 14. Wayne DeZubak with Bob Devaney back here in Norman for the final 6 minutes, 41 seconds of this game. Total offense, unofficially, Nebraska 425 yards, Oklahoma 320. You see a slight breeze from the southeast. The Huskers with a third and four situation from the 46-yard line. Rozier looking for some running room. He's got a blocker. Nice block by Maurer.
It's close. He almost got a first down out of that. Mike Rozier did a tremendous job of running. He was cornered back behind the line of scrimmage. He may be just a little short. It looks like he's about a yard short, and it will bring up a punting situation.
Watch the block if we... what a block that Mark Maurer gave Mike Rozier, and that really allowed it to be close.
Right. It was Maurer did a real fine job blocking. And he picked off a man that would have had Mike Rozier behind the line of scrimmage. Mike almost got the first down.
Well, Roger Craig and Mike Rozier have now both gone over 100 yards. Craig with 102, Rozier with 100. So they are right on the button. Fair catch call for by Albert Watts. And Albert Watts, number 17, just a freshman.
Oklahoma went after that kick. Once more, they put a lot of pressure on the right side, but the kicker got the kickoff. Campbell got the kickoff plenty of time.
Not a bad punt, 41 yards.
Campbell has been a real excellent punter for us this year. Our overall kicking game has been excellent, and the punting by Campbell has been as good as we've had in many years.
Oklahoma with the ball on their own 18-yard line, first and 10. Stanley Wilson, big hole. Brad Evans gets him. But Wilson will be out. Enough yardage for the first down.
I tell you one thing, Barry Switzer has not given up on this ball game. At least he's got his best football player in there. Right at the end of the ball game, Stanley Wilson, he must have gained he must be close to 200 yards carrying the football, but he seems to still keep coming on.
Final score from Des Moines, Drake 53 and injury-riddled UNO team nothing. 53-0 Drake over UNO this afternoon in Des Moines.
They used to live down here.
And another pass play. Oklahoma here's in trouble, though.
Phelps, he's going to be dumped back at the 21-yard line. Loss of 8.
A Nebraska rushed that time. They came with about 6 people, and they just had too many people. Oklahoma, a team that is not a passing team, has difficulty picking up extra men coming through on a passing play, and it showed in that situation.
I'll tell you what, it'd be interesting to get the difference, to show you that Nebraska group that is down here, and then show you some of the other stands to show you that there's not a Nebraska person left this stadium, and I want to guarantee you, there are a lot of Sooner fans walking home. Well, you can see from that shot right there, there are a lot of empty seats here right now.
And here's a pass. It's complete, but it's short, about 6 yards of a first down. It'll create a third down and 6 situation. And I think we'll probably see Oklahoma coming back with another pass unless they want to work Stanley Wilson again.
Well, I'll tell you, Shepard came in here, and he's a better passer. Kelly Phelps is a better passer than Shepard. But the first time that Phelps was in there in this game, he made a horrendous mistake. Phelps now... 3 for 5.
And Oklahoma is in a wing formation again with 2 split people. And this time there was a quick pass over the middle that was overthrown, was incomplete. And Oklahoma is going to be forced to punt. Nebraska will have another chance to put some points on the board.
Oscars will get the ball back with about 4 minutes remaining in this ball game, and I am sure that they will just do everything they can to take that ball and run it out. Again, a reminder, the Huskers going off the Orange Bowl.
Okay.
Todd Brown's pretty happy about it. Todd Brown, who really got hit a while back. Huskers off to the Orange Bowl, and they will be doing so in style.
And this will be a happy team that goes to the Orange Bowl. It'll be a team that are really, truly champions, and I know how badly they wanted to win this ball game to go down there with a clean record in Big 8 competition.
They'll be 7-0, 9-2 overall, and again, we have to go back and tell you that Clemson was winning today. I don't know what the final score is on that game yet, and that's important because if Clemson wins, they will definitely finish the year in second place in the ratings next week. Pittsburgh will play Penn State. Penn State beat Notre Dame today, 24-21, so maybe Penn State can pick it up and do it twice in a row and beat Pittsburgh. That would mean Clemson could be number one, Nebraska maybe third or fourth. That's why the Clemson game is important, and we're just getting an update. Is that a final? Clemson 29, South Carolina 23, so things are looking orangey for the Orange Bowl people, with Clemson winning today over South Carolina, 29-23. So we could have and should have 2 top 5 teams playing in the Orange Bowl. What a New Year's night. Good rush by Nebraska, but Keeling gets it away. Oscars let it bounce. It goes out of bounds at the 29-yard line.
Nebraska take over in their own 29. It's question now whether they'll, how many substitutes they'll put in this ball game, if any, and just what they will do, whether they're going to try to sit on this ball and keep running it, or whether they're going to keep throwing the football. At this stage of the game, it looks like the game is won, but it's just a matter now of holding on to the ball, not making any mistakes that would get Oklahoma an easy scoring opportunity.
Well, they've got a lot of new people in there right now. Bruce Matheson, of course, is that quarterback. That's Anthony Steele's in motion. Rozier is still the eye back. He's going to be taken down by Jackie Schiff, gain of maybe about a yard out to the 31.
Now Mike Rozier and Roger Craig both have carried the ball a lot today and have both been extremely effective, as you mentioned earlier, both of them having 100-yard or better days. Phil Bates has had a good day at fullback, and we can't emphasize how well Mark Maurer has played at quarterback.
Bob, there's 4:16 left to go. Look at that shot. I think when's the last time you've seen a stadium that empty with 4:16 to go in a Nebraska-Oklahoma game?
I think that's about as empty as I've ever seen it.
Matheson makes the turn. He'll keep it. He's got running room. Matheson,
Matheson is done well at quarterback. He hasn't had too much chance to play. He's been a third-string quarterback this year, but Bruce has done a real fine job. He's an excellent passer. I don't know if we're going to see him throwing the ball much today, but he certainly ran that option play very well.
Out to the 47-yard line, first down. I almost thought he fumbled the ball, but I guess I was wrong. Nebraska first and 10 from the 47. A lot of new players in there now. Tom Burgess wide at the top of your screen. Yeah, but this is Rozier. The old hand at it. Gets maybe a yard.
Maybe one.
Rozier, what a day he's had. Second quarter score now, UCLA 13, Southern Cal 12. What a game we have going there out on the coast. And, of course, as soon as this game is complete and we have 3 minutes and 30 seconds to go, we will join that game in progress. Second down, and let's call it 9. They probably gave Rozier a 1 yard gain on that one, even though it was closer to a half yard gain. Rozier up the middle, inside Oklahoma territory to the 49.
An Oklahoma team now is it's a beaten football team. They're not giving up, but they're just going through the motions, you might say, and Nebraska's keep controlling this ball. They've got third down now, and if they make this first down, why, they're going to keep on marching down here and could put another score on the board. But I think the big thing that Tom Eisler's thinking about now, he's not worried about putting any more scores on, just to see this, the people that are in this ball game play well. Now, there's a screen pass that really went awry. I think the receiver was not in the spot where Matheson thought he was going to be.
You know, Bob, talk about the Oklahoma Sooners. They are expected to get a Sun Bowl bid later today. At least there are six representatives from that bowl here, and that's been the talk all week in Oklahoma City and in Norman. And right now, after this game, they're going to be 5-4-1. Oklahoma State's playing pretty good ball up in Ames today. That could be interesting later on.
You're right. Oklahoma State could possibly beat Oklahoma.
So it should be interesting. They could end up at 5-5-1 after next week. It falls on the ground, finally picked up, and the Sooners are going to have terrible field position at their 6-yard line with 2:30 to go in the ballgame. The score, Nebraska 37, the Oklahoma Sooners 14. Well, the last of the sun starting to set here in Oklahoma, and it set about two quarters ago for Oklahoma faithful. They started to leave, some of them, even at the half when Nebraska had a 24-7 lead. The Nebraska Cornhuskers now a 37-14 lead with 2 minutes and 32 seconds left to go on the ball game. Oklahoma backed up at their own 8-yard line.
And the stands are about three-fourths emptied on the side of Oklahoma. And we have Kelly Phelps handing the ball off. The fullback makes about 7 yards on the play, which is almost inconsequential at this stage of the game.
But what a game Stanley Wilson has had. He has been the one Sooner that I have really been impressed with today. He hasn't made a mistake. He has really played well.
Well, Wayne, I'm surprised that Stanley is still in the game. I kind of think maybe Barry saves Stanley for better things next week.
He's such a valuable ball player, you would really think so, because they've still, if they do get the Sun Bowl bid left, they've got right. 2 games left.
Right, they've got that, and Wilson has played a great game, as you say, but he's taken an awful pounding
that
here.
It is.
And he's doing it right now in a losing cause, and it would really wreck Oklahoma's chances next week or in any bowl game if they were playing it without Wilson.
So the Huskers are going to go 9-2 overall. What a year after being 1-2 to begin with. They come back and to win all these games in a row to go 9-2 on the season, 7-0 in the Big 8. Truly, in 1981, the Big 8 champions.
And this is a real fine defensive play. Oklahoma fumbles, but it goes out of bounds. But the great credit has to be given to Tom Osborne and his staff for the great job they've done here. Gene Huey and some of the other coaches are going from the press box now, but they really have done a tremendous job of coaching this year, one of the best jobs I've ever seen.
All the coaches coming over, congratulating Bob Devaney, the athletic director here, and it's a happy bunch of Nebraska people here, and so it's 1:14 to go, 37-14, Nebraska with the lead. Phelps looking to pass, does so over the middle, incomplete, flag on the play.
I think they're going to call pass interference here. That's, I don't know exactly the reason for that call, because the pass was about 10 yards over the receiver's head. I don't quite understand it, but and if you think by now the officials would want to go home. It's getting kind of late in the day. It's getting kind of cold here. I don't think if I was officiating, I'd be throwing that flag around much this stage.
Time to call it quits. 1:10 to go in this one, and it is basically history.
And they're having a conference now to find out just what to do here.
Marching it off right now. It'll be a first down at any rate for the Oklahoma Sooners out at the 37-yard line. Second quarter score, UCLA 18, USC 12. It seems like they've got the kind of a ball game that should be interesting in the second half, and that's about where we'll pick it up as we'll join that game in progress at the completion of this one. But I know Husker fans are really enjoying the end of this one, just savoring it all the better. Rodney Lewis, that pass was never going to be completed. If anything, Lewis could have got it.
No, Phelps was throwing it, you might say he was just throwing it south. And the closest receiver was Rodney Lewis. Oklahoma, a team that has, in some years, passed the ball exceptionally well. In fact, back in 1971, they kept themselves in the game with Jack Mildren throwing the ball. But this year's Oklahoma team, while they have a fine running attack, their passing attack is not very potent.
Well, I watched the entire Oklahoma-Missouri game, and Darrell Shepard, even the one touchdown he tossed was tipped by a Missouri defender, and they really do not have any kind of passing attack.
Well, they called a pass interference call there, and I happened to be watching the play, and I think it was a correct call. They called it on Alan Lyday, and it looked like he did have the receiver in his grasp there before the ball got there.
Kind of pushed off of him a little bit.
Right.
So we're right down to an even 1 minute to go in this ball game, and even all these penalties that they are receiving right now is anticlimactic. There is no way, and you can see the Husker bench. They're a pretty happy bunch of people. Tom Osborne, a big sigh of relief. Ball at the 48 in Nebraska. First down for Oklahoma. Phelps out into the flat. Nice catch there by Sewell, and he is going to be stopped short of the 45-yard line.
Actually, the pass play netted about a 2-yard gain. There was a lot of action on it, but not much distance, and this kind of a passing attack is not going to put Oklahoma on the board. Although, I'll say this in their behalf, they have not quit trying. They've been going all out to try to get on the board.
They'd like to get on the board one more time, make it 37-21. Sewell's pass incomplete, and I tell you what, Alan Lyday let him know he was there.
Right. And it's a good thing it was incomplete. It's been thrown much further. I think Lyday had the best chance of anybody to catch it. It was thrown way out in the flat. Lighty had the receiver real well covered, and the pass was thrown behind the receiver.
And he had about 70 yards of green turf ahead of him.
Right.
Down to 27 seconds. Clock stop, of course, on the incompleted pass. Usually there's a traffic jam trying to get out of Owen Field, but today it may be so spaced out that you don't have any problem. Pass incomplete. Drops to the turf.
It was really a very well thrown pass. It was a delay pass across the middle, but the receiver had it right in his hands. It was a perfect pass, but he dropped it, so all it is an incompletion, and it's now fourth down, and I guess Oklahoma's not going to punt the football. Looks like they're gonna go ahead and play the last 21 seconds.
Did you see the fox there? Look at that. Don Bryant.
Don Bryant's down there with a cigar in his mouth, and I think he's enjoying what appears to be a very apparent victory.
And we just saw Tom Osborne smiling a moment ago. A happy group of Huskers. Pass, Shepard, incomplete, almost intercepted.
I think we probably have about one more play left in this ball game, and Nebraska has the football, and I don't think they're going to try to do anything spectacular. It's been nice working with you, Wayne. It's awfully nice to watch Nebraska Cornhuskers play this kind of a game. They played a tremendous football game.
Well, the clock has stopped at 14 minutes, and I'll tell you what, the fans on the far side, there's only a couple of areas that have not been vacated yet, and that is where Nebraska has been assigned seats at the stadium. And a lot of people are very, very happy. The Huskers have accomplished the goal that they wanted to, the Big 8 championship. There you see the empty side. And as you pan down, you will start to pick up the side where there are still some Husker fans. Well, first of all, we want to go back to live action. Dungarden with the ball carrier. 5 seconds. And that's it. 3-2-1. It's all over. The Cornhuskers have beaten the Oklahoma Sooners by the score 37-14 as they carry Tom Osborne off the field here at Owen Field.
Terry Switzer's coming across the field to congratulate Tom. You see him right here in the middle of the field now.
So the final score, 37-14, Nebraska the winner. Will be back in just a minute.
Tomorrow's...
I'll tell you what, both Nebraska I-backs today went over 100 yards rushing, and a happy bunch of Nebraska fans on the field. And Bob, 37-14, the final score today. I don't know. I think it was surprising to me, although I felt that if anybody could win this one big today, it would be Nebraska.
Right, and this was one of the greatest victories that I've ever seen while I've been at the University of Nebraska. It's just great that they played with without a quarterback who done a tremendous job for them. And I think a lot of people look like, well, they're going down here and they're going to have a heck of a time. They come up with probably as good a ball game as they played all season. And I want to take my hat off to Mark Maurer and to the other Cornhusker and to Tom Osborne and his staff for really preparing this team for this ball game. They've done a tremendous job.
But a super game for the Nebraska Cornhuskers, 37-14, the final. We'll be back with a final comment for you right after this timeout. A happy bunch of Cornhusker fans here today. They were the only ones to stay the full 60 minutes of this ball game as the Nebraska Cornhuskers go 9-2 on the year, 7-0 in the Big 8 Conference to truly prove that they are indeed the Big 8 champions of 1981 with that 37-14 win this afternoon. They jumped out to a 24-7 lead, and there was almost no doubt from the beginning that Nebraska was indeed going to win it. Oklahoma looking terribly impressive, going 80 yards in only 6 plays that first drive, but Nebraska came back and led 24-7 at the half, and what a day for Nebraska. They will be going on to the Orange Bowl, most likely to play the Tigers of Clemson, a team that won today. It could be a battle of top 5 teams, so it should be interesting. That is it here from Owen Field in Norman, Oklahoma. For Bob Devaney, I'm Wayne DeZubak. We want to thank you very much for joining us here today for Nebraska football. Again, the final, the Nebraska Cornhuskers 37 and the Oklahoma Sooners 14. We want to join now in progress that game on the West Coast between USC and UCLA. So long from Norman.
KETV's live coverage of the Nebraska-Oklahoma game has been brought to you by Runza, home of the sandwich that's a meal in itself. Nebraska Furniture Mart. When you shop the Nebraska Furniture Mart, you'll know that you got the best for less. Those friendly people at the Ralston Bank, home of innovative banking. True Value Hardware. Zenith. And by Northwestern Bell. This has been an exclusive 7TV sports presentation.